The Honorable, the Chief Justice and the Associate Justices of the Supreme Court of the Philippines. Hear ye, hear ye, hear ye. All persons having business before the Honorable Supreme Court of the Philippines shall give their attention, for the court is now in session. Hear ye, hear ye, hear ye.
The Clerk of Court will please call the matter at hand.
Year number 221697, Mary Grace Natividad S. Paul Yamansares versus Commission on Elections and Estrella C. Elamparo, and GR numbers 221698 to 700, Mary Grace Natividad S. Paul Yamansares versus Commission on Elections, Francisco S. Tatad, Antonio P. Contreras, and Amado D. Valdez. Appearing as counsel for petitioner are Attorney Alexander J. Poblador, Attorney Dino Vivencio A.A. Tamayo, Attorney Justine Christopher C. Mendoza, Attorney Sandra May T. Magalang, and Attorney George Erwin M. Garcia. Appearing as counsel for public respondent are the following: Commissioner Arthur D. Lim and Commissioner Maria Rowena Amelia V. Guanzon. For private respondent in GR number 221697, Attorney Estrella C. Elamparo. Counsel for private respondent Francisco Estatad in GR numbers 221698 to 700, Attorney Manuelito R. Luna. Private respondent Dr. Antonio P. Contreras in GR numbers 221698 to 700, Dr. Antonio P. Contreras. And counsel for private respondent Amado D. Valdez in GR numbers 221698 to 700, we have Attorney Amado D. Valdez, Attorney Melquiades Marcos N. Valdez II, Attorney Donna S. Agoncillo, Attorney Mark Andrew M. Santiago, and Attorney Lawrence Angelo G. Dionisio. From the Office of the Solicitor General, we have Solicitor General Florin T. Hilbay.
Councils will please take their seats. I will just confirm the instruction given the Commission on Elections by the Clerk of Court that should Commissioner Guanzon, who is slated to speak first before the Commission on Elections, not consume the entirety of her 3 minutes, the rest of the time will be added to the time allotted to Commissioner Arthur Lim. Thank you, Commissioner Guanzon. So shall we now resume the interpellations to be started by Justice Marvic Leonen. Attorney Poblador is requested to please approach the podium. Justice Leonen.
Thank you, Chief.
Good afternoon, the Council. Court.
Good afternoon. So last time we were talking about constitutional interpretation. But first, by the way, are we in terms of the relationship of the domestic jurisdiction to the international, are we considered a monist or a dualist?
In connection with international law, I think we follow the dualist principle.
In other words, that international law does not is not part of the Constitution, that it only comes in as a matter of provisions in the Constitution, that there is a separate sphere between international law and domestic law. Is that correct?
Yes.
And it can come via Article 2, generally accepted principles of international law shall form part of the law of the land, or Article 7. Is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Of course, there is a lex specialis, which is Article, for instance, Article 18, Section 25, which was recently interpreted by this court. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
That's with respect to the EDCA. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And this is because our theory is that the Constitution is created by our people. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And it is not created by the community of nations. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes, and as far as we are concerned, when we say generally accepted principles of law form part of the law of the land, we do not mean that that law is the Constitution.
I agree, Your Honor.
So first and foremost, what we should be interpreting are the text of the Constitution. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And in order that international law becomes part of the law of the land, then we have to show either that it is a treaty ratified by us under Article 7, Section 21. Is that not correct?
Yes, that's one part of
one
the
part.
Concept.
The other part is that it enters our jurisdiction via quote and unquote, generally accepted principles of law. Is that not correct?
International law, yes, Your Honor.
Yes. Generally accepted principles of international law, that's the text of the Constitution. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
But in international law, basic international law that is, the sources of law are either customary law and general principles of law. Is that not correct?
General principles recognized by
Article 38 of
yes,
the ICJ statute.
Recognized by civilized nations.
Yes. Although our constitution says generally accepted principles of international law, does that refer only to the second source or that also refers to the first source?
That term includes both categories, Your Honor.
Yes. Would you have jurisprudence to support that?
Yes. The case of Razon versus Tagitis, Mijares versus Renada, where the Supreme Court applied both concepts to establish whether or not a treaty to which the Philippines is not a party constitutes generally accepted principles of international law.
Okay, just to be clear, international law, does it amend the Constitution?
No, Your Honor.
International law, can it change the meaning of our Constitution?
No, Your Honor.
You're definite about that?
Except perhaps in the, as a general principle, that is correct because the Constitution is supreme,
okay.
Your Honor.
Let's stop there for a while and look at specifics later. This court is now exercising its power of judicial review. Is that not correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
And there is such a thing as a doctrine of avoidance. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Where is this situated in the Constitution, this concept of doctrine of avoidance?
I believe that if the Supreme Court can avoid addressing a constitutional issue, it should not address that constitutional issue, and it should do so only if necessary.
No, I mean, where is it situated textually? What's the anchor of deference? For example, deference to the actions of the COMELEC, the legislature, or for that matter, deference to the action of the electorate.
It can be in the rules of court, like Rule 64 and Rule 65, and then the Constitution itself with regard to the power of judicial
let's
review.
Let's stay within the Constitution because the rules of court is flows from the Constitution. I just want to make sure of my bearings as I continue with the interpolation.
Yes.
So where is it situated?
The Constitution itself provides for the manner of reviewing decisions of the COMELEC, and it says the Supreme Court can review if there's grave abuse of discretion, it can set aside the
decision. Only legally demandable rights and obligations, is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
This court does not render advisory opinions, is that not correct?
That's correct.
And therefore, if there is a way by which we can narrowly tailor the issues in order to come out with a result that would be better in terms of our constitutional order.
Yes, Your Honor.
Why is that?
Well, because of the structure itself of the Constitution defines powers of various agencies, and the Supreme Court is there to review their actuations to determine whether or not they act within the perimeters of their powers.
No, I mean, so, why? Why is it that this body, this Supreme Court, what is the rationale that will convince us not to exercise this extraordinary power of judicial review? You see, counsel, we can trump a political act. We can trump an entire law. We can trump the actions of the COMELEC. In fact, we can trump the decision of the electorate in the coming election by disqualifying one candidate, two candidates, three candidates. So what is stopping us from doing so? Why is there this policy of avoidance?
Well, I think it boils down to the presumption of regularity accorded to government actuations. So the Supreme Court itself should limit its power of review. And
are we a democratic country?
Yes, Your Honor.
A democratic state?
Yes, Your Honor.
We are a democratic and republican state. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
What does republican mean?
A form of government where those placed in charge of government are elected by the people and therefore they represent the people.
Is this court elected?
Pardon me, Your
Honor. Have we been elected?
No, Your Honor.
No.
You were appointed.
So we come in only to interpret a provision of law. But if the provision of law is broad enough that there are certain ambiguities, and it is possible that there is a political organ that can actually decide on it, should we not defer to it?
Yes, Your Honor. Certain questions are essentially meant for political organs or even the people itself. So
the other hand, if the text is clear, given contemporary readings of that text and the actual facts that emanate from a case, if it is clear, is it not also our duty to implement the provisions of the Constitution?
Yes, if the law is clear, but clarity cannot depend only on the face of a law. It can be ambiguous because, for example, it excludes a certain class of people which should not be excluded.
You're going already into specifics. I just want to get my bearings first in this set of prefatory questions. So when interpreting the Constitution, it cannot also be vox populi, vox Dei. Is that not correct?
Not as a general rule, yes. But I think there are...
In other words, we cannot say that we don't want to decide. We want the people to decide first, period. It is that there is a text in the Constitution which says this, and therefore this is what we will allow the text to operate. This is how we will allow the text to operate.
That's
not correct.
Correct as a general rule, but again, there are exceptions when.
So there is a middle ground between dura lex et lex on the one hand. The law may be harsh, but it is the law, right? And on the other, vox populi, vox Dei. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Dura lex et lex. Must we apply the law even if we think it is unreasonable?
No, courts are not only courts of law, but they're also courts of equity. In case of doubt, it is presumed that the law intended right and justice to prevail.
We have to look at the rationale behind the text in order to be able to give it life. Is that not correct?
That's correct, Your
Honor. But if there is text, then we cannot go beyond the text and nullify that text. Is that not correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Now, when we interpret the text of the Constitution, do we automatically go to a historical document?
In case of doubt, courts usually...
So the first thing that we need to look at is the text itself, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And then the text means the text, the phrase, and the sentence. Is that not correct?
Correct, Your Honor.
And after that, the normative order of that text, whether it serves as guidance or there is a clear prestation contained there. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And guidance means a statement of policy like Article 2, and then actual prestation, like for instance, the prohibitions for those that cannot run for president. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
So there is a normative order. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And also, before we go out of the four corners of the document, we have to look at all the entire estate, the entire real estate of that document. Is that not correct?
That's correct.
So Article 2 will come into play when necessary. Article 9, Section C, Paragraph C will come into play. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And of course, we need to look at our precedents. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
But the precedents, since we are not a common law country, do not in fact replace the text of the Constitution. Is that not correct?
Yes, although...
Yes. So, can you explain to me why it's necessary to go into the deliberations of the 1935 Constitution? In your pleadings, it seems that that was an issue between you and some of the comments. Of course, they were responding to you. Why is it that we need to go to the 35 Constitution?
because there is, we believe that when you apply the provision of the Constitution, Section 1, Article 4, which relates to citizens who are children of fathers who are Filipinos, or those who are born of Filipino fathers, there is an ambiguity if we exclude foundlings. So it becomes necessary to go into the intent of the framers when they deliberated precisely on that section.
Excuse me, but in the dialogue that is in the transcript, there were only two people that were discussing it. Is that not correct?
That's correct, but their opinions were never opposed or resisted.
And by the way, in response to Justice Carpio, Justice Carpio said that there was an interpretation of why the amendment did not hold. And you gave also a different interpretation.
Yes.
Now, which one is correct?
Well, with due respect,
the opinion of the justices at the very end, the collective opinion of the justices will prevail for a time because that becomes doctrine. And yours is an advocacy. Is that not correct? Yes. But in terms of looking at, shall we say, a more stable, a more objective way of interpreting what happened in that deliberation.
Yes.
Well, so your interpretation was that because the amendment was not carried, it was because of the reasons behind that amendment. The other interpretation is because the amendment was not carried, the concept was foundlings are not natural born citizens. So there are two interpretations, right?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes. And your guess is as good as mine where we will lay, correct?
If I may explain our position, there I think the Constitutional Convention were deliberating on the particular phrase, those born in the Philippines or in foreign territory of mothers or fathers who are citizens of the Philippines. Mr. Raffles wanted to amend that particular proposed...
Yes. Again, counsel, there were two people in that discussion.
Actually, there were four.
But there were all the members that actually voted. And the act of all the members was not to amend.
Yes.
But why they did not amend, of course, not only two of them spoke.
Yes.
Do we assume that all the intentions of the others are the same as those that spoke? This is the problem of original intent, correct?
Actually, three voices express certain statements there.
Yes, counsel. And the discomfort here is you're not talking about the deliberations of the 87.
Yes.
Nor the 73, nor the only the 35.
Your Honors, we do not...
So why not go all the way? Why not talk about the Malolos Constitution?
Your Honors...
Or for that matter, you see the Treaty of Paris, also in Article 9, contained a provision on citizenship. Native inhabitants versus Spanish, the peninsulares and the insulares were recognized in that single provision in the Treaty of Paris. So well, in any case, maybe you can cover this in your memoranda, the relevance of that discussion. Counsel. And perhaps because these are questions addressed to you, when I ask questions to you, even though it is a very persuasive argument, it is also addressed to everybody, correct? Which means that the COMELEC and the private respondents may also cover in their memorandum strong arguments which they feel are made against their case or for their case. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
If I may...
When is citizenship res judicata?
Well,
when is the determination of citizenship res judicata? Is there doctrine to that effect?
There are several doctrines which say that judgments with respect to citizenship cannot reach the level of res judicata because that issue can be raised.
No, there is. Go versus Ramos. Are you familiar with that case? This is in 2009.
If I may state the general proposition first, I don't agree with the general proposition anyway, but there is that principle that judgments relating to citizenship never become res judicata.
No, in Go versus Ramos, it said there are three elements before citizenship becomes res judicata for every purpose. Of course, these are: one, it was material to the controversy; second, there was participation by the Solicitor General; and third, it must be affirmed by the Supreme Court.
Your Honor, I think that case the context of that case, I think, involves naturalization, where the Solicitor General is expected to participate. But even, I think, so long as a decision which relates to citizenship, for example, relates to status or political status, we apply the rules of court which say they become conclusive unless, and here's where the peculiar character of citizenship issues will come in. Unless, for example, there's a change in the status, because citizenship can change, citizenship can be lost, citizenship which the
but your theory is natural born citizenship is never lost. When it's reacquired again, it goes back to natural born citizenship. Is that not correct?
In the situation where repatriation laws apply, citizenship which is lost can be reacquired.
Let's put it this way, counsel. What is your position?
Our position is
was the petitioner natural born upon birth?
Yes, Your Honor.
And when she applied under 9225, did all the acts required of her under 9225, did she acquire again natural born citizenship?
Yes, Your Honor.
The SET decision, the SET decision, okay, does it fall within Goh versus Ramos? Is it res judicata for the COMELEC?
It is res judicata because the condition of petitioner has not changed. There is no new evidence which can justify a different conclusion from COMELEC.
And I suppose that is the same position for the your conclusion that the Bureau of Immigration's commissioner's decision is also res judicata. Same rationale.
The section 47, rule 39 refers to determinations of courts and judges, courts which include the SET. We're not prepared to to say outright that the decisions of the Bureau of Immigration will constitute res judicata, especially since they're under the supervision of the DOJ, and there's a provision for a revocation of findings of the Bureau of Immigration by the DOJ.
Okay. This is from sections, this case arose out of section 78. It's a section 78 of the Omnibus Election Code, which directly grants the COMELEC power.
Yes, sir.
Okay,
sure.
Of course, that section is the child of a mother provision in the Constitution. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, section 78, and this is raised to us via Rule 64.
Yes, Your Honor.
In relation to 65. And we are to look at grave abuse of discretion on the part of the respondent, COMELEC. Is that not correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Yes. Would you say that looking into the citizenship now, the nature of the citizenship, determining whether it's natural or naturalized, is a collateral or a direct attack?
It would be a collateral. On the part of COMELEC, it would be a collateral attack.
Now that your client, the petitioner, is not a natural-born citizen, does that apply for all purposes? For example, for the Senate, does she lose her seat in the Senate? Or does it only apply for her candidacy for president?
Well, a finding by this court, assuming it will address the issue on the merits, a finding by this court that the petitioner is not a natural-born citizen can raise questions as to the validity of the SET decision, because the SET decision is also before this court at the present time.
Okay. Here, this one I need to understand very clearly. Your position is that the COMELEC's jurisdiction was only to decide on whether there was false or material misrepresentation.
That's correct, Your Honor.
Okay. It was not to decide the qualification of the candidate.
Not per se, Your Honor.
Not per se to decide the qualification of the candidate. And why do you say so?
Well, because the jurisprudence itself with regard to Section 78 says, and I cite, for example, the case of Fermin, the decision to set aside or to cancel a COC is not based on disqualification, but it is based on material misrepresentation.
Yes, per justice natura, let it be not misunderstood, lest it be misunderstood. The denial of due course to or cancellation is not based on the lack of qualifications, but on a finding that the candidate made a material misrepresentation that is false.
That's correct.
More recently, Villafuerte versus Comelec, under the pen of Justice Peralta, also made that same point. And then in the case of Guzman versus Comelec, written by Justice Bersamin for a full court again, that false representation is a question of fact. Okay, I understand that there is that jurisprudence, but constitutionally, can we not expand it?
Yes, I would believe that interpretation is squarely based on the Constitution. Because
in the comment of the Comelec, I think this one is the first division, the first comment that was filed, cited is Bedol versus Comelec, where the Supreme Court held that any act or any power necessary and proper for the assurance of a free, fair, clean, honest, orderly election, this is in Bedol versus Comelec, is deemed also granted to the Comelec. Now, we have restricting jurisprudence of the actions of the Comelec with respect to certain levels of officials in terms of their qualification. So you cite Fermin, Villafuerte, Guzman, and many others. But on the other hand, we have expanding jurisdiction like Bedol versus Comelec. So one set of jurisprudence versus the other. Is there something more objective, like for instance, maybe again situated in the Constitution?
Yes, Your Honor.
What part of the Constitution?
The sections enumerating the powers of the Comelec. For example, and if I may cite at least three of these powers, the first power is the power to enforce or administer election laws. Second power is to exercise original and exclusive jurisdiction to decide questions relating to elections, returns, and qualifications of local government officials, regional, provincial, and city. And then the third power is the power to decide questions affecting election law, except the right to vote, which to me is significant. But because that
let's go to that. Article 9, subparagraph C, no, Article C, 9C, Section 2, and I think I had my staff have this provision, Section 2, Number 3. There is a qualifier there, except those involving the right to vote.
To me,
and
that's,
you did mention that.
That's significant because...
What is the significance of this provision?
The right to vote turns on questions of residence and citizenship. So if the Comelec cannot even resolve that, then there's doubt as to whether or not they can resolve issues of qualification with respect to candidates for president or to candidates for national positions.
Well, we said that every provision of the law must have some rationale behind it. Why did the Constitution, or why did the people in their sovereign power, from this text alone, why do you think it removed this power from the Comelec, except those involving the right to vote? You see, when people vote, this is part of the election. And people would want to know whether they can participate or not. And Comelec, in fact, deputizes every government agency, marshals all the resources in order that there is a credible vote. So why is it that they remove the power from Comelec to decide on who votes?
Because I think of the fundamental character of the right of suffrage in a Republican government. Because the issue is a very significant one. I think the intent really is to leave that issue to the courts.
Why?
Because of the importance of the right of suffrage in the context of a Republican government.
The Comelec is not a constitutional body?
Yes, but it is a body with limited jurisdiction.
Perhaps you can cover this more in your memoranda, and I ask the respondents to also do so, to clarify why there is such a distinction. And by the way, are we entitled to infer more than the words except those involving the right to vote? The right to vote is different from the right to be voted upon. Is that not correct?
They are corollary rights, Your
yes.
Honor.
They are related. Like a brother and sister is related to each other, but the brother is always different from the sister. Is that not correct? So, again, can we infer? from this, except those involving the right to vote, the fact that COMELEC cannot decide on who can be voted upon.
Again, Your Honor.
Can we infer from this text, involving the right to vote, that COMELEC is also excluded from determining who can be voted upon?
Yes, insofar as the issues of citizenship and residence are the subject matter of the issue whether or not a candidate has a right to be voted, then I think we can infer from this that the COMELEC should not be allowed to resolve questions of residence and citizenship, especially in regard to national officers.
I guess that can be more explained in your memoranda also further. Free, orderly, honest, peaceful, and credible elections. That is the duty of COMELEC, to ensure that there are free, orderly, honest, peaceful, and credible. This appears in subparagraph 4. It appears in subparagraph 7 of section 2 of article 9C. Can we situate in this text free, orderly, honest, peaceful, and credible the power of the COMELEC to remove Noe Sanz candidates?
I think because of this exception, Your Honor, I don't think we can infer from the power of the COMELEC to ensure orderly, peaceful elections. I don't think we can infer from that the power to decide questions of qualifications.
Okay. No, not questions of qualifications, but removing a Noe Sanz candidate.
That's entirely a different matter because...
Is it situated in this power that the COMELEC can ensure an orderly, free, honest election? Because if there are candidates which are not really serious, Noe Sanz,
yes,
or cannot manage a national campaign for that matter, if they're national candidates, then therefore it affects the results of the election. Is that not correct?
I agree, Your Honor.
It affects also the ballot. The ballot as it is, I can only imagine, is going to be again very, very long. Back and forth, I suppose. I'm not sure. But the point is that it's COMELEC's duty to make sure that everyone in the ballot is eligible and qualified and not Noe Sanz. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And therefore, can we say that COMELEC also has the power to determine qualifications?
Your Honor, the provisions on nuisance candidates avoid words like citizenship, resident, or qualifications. The basis for removing nuisance candidates is that their evident intent really is not to run, but only to sow confusion.
Is a Noe Sanz candidate qualified to run?
He may have those
if
qualifications.
If there is a candidate who is more than 40 years old, able to read and write, you see, the qualifications for president are at its minimum. There is no property requirement. Natural born, resident of the Philippines for more than 10 years, qualified. Can he or she be disqualified as a Noe Sanz candidate still?
Well, he may have those qualifications. Still, he can be disqualified as a Noe Sanz candidate because the disqualification here goes into his evident intent. Is he serious about running, or is his purpose only to sow confusion in the electoral process?
This is my problem. If COMELEC can remove a Noe Sanz candidate who is all qualified, how much more that COMELEC must be able to remove a person that is not qualified?
Well, there may be logic in that statement, but you always go back to the powers of the COMELEC in the Constitution. Can it determine questions of qualifications with regard to candidates to national office?
I think,
Your Honor, well, the first three powers, Your 9C, Honor, of the,
Section yes. 2, Paragraph 2, correct?
Yes. Yes.
Exclusive original jurisdiction over qualifications only of regional, etc. And then Article 7, Section, the seventh paragraph, which gives to this court the power to determine qualifications. Well, maybe again, this can be covered more definitely in your memoranda. Okay.
Yes, Your Honor.
False or material misrepresentation. Villafuerte, which summarizes many of the cases, Villafuerte, again, the ponencia under Justice Peralta, clearly states that there must be intent to deceive the general population. Okay, let's go to that a little bit, in a little bit. Ignorantia legis non excusat. Can you translate that?
ignorance of the law excuses no one from compliance therewith.
Okay, so questions of law are supposed to be, shall we say, presumed to be known by every citizen. Is that not correct?
That's true, Your Honor.
A law, and that this law is interpreted in this way, correct?
Subject to limitations, that is true, Your Honor.
Yes. Therefore, if there is a conclusive presumption, because that cannot be made as a defense in any case, right? That I did not know that there was such a law. That cannot be made as a defense, correct?
It can be made as a defense if the charge, Your Honor, is deceit, fraud. When it comes to charges of this nature,
so you are saying
good faith
material misrepresentation in Section 78 does not only refer to questions of fact, it also refers to questions of law.
Yes, Your Honor.
So there can be misrepresentation as to a question of law.
That's correct, Your Honor. As
you're changing your theory now. You're accepting the position that material misrepresentation can only be with respect to a question of fact, meaning to say, did the petitioner come in on May 2005?
Your Honor,
not the conclusion that because of that, she was establishing her residence.
The question whether a candidate is a natural born citizen is not purely a question of fact. It is also a question of law. In the case of Texon, for example, the question there was, the issue there was whether or not Fernando Po could, in good faith, claim that he was a natural born citizen.
So you're saying that material misrepresentation can refer to questions of fact and questions of law.
When these issues are mixed, Your Honor, there can be a degree of misrepresentation if there was a fraudulent intent to misrepresent.
What is a question of fact?
A fact which deals solely on matters which can be factually shown to be true or not.
It can be validated.
Yes.
So the question of fact refers to the weighing of the evidence.
That's correct,
Your Honor. That is presented. So the conclusion of fact arises from the presentation of exhibits. Is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And question of law is an inference from the existence of a fact, correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
There is a major premise there. The major premise is a provision of law.
It can also mean interpretation of the law, Your Honor, without
provision
regard to the facts.
Provision of law and sub-premise, the interpretation of that law. Natural-born citizen is, these are the facts, therefore, this happens. Okay. So therefore, it is possible, therefore, the COMELEC had jurisdiction to say that a person was natural born or not natural born.
Only, not per se, but only to determine whether or not a candidate could, in good faith, make a conclusion without being accused of deceit.
Okay. But you see the drift of my questions, and I wish that to be covered in the memoranda that you will be presenting. Okay. Let's go to the meat of the issue. Qualifications for president, Article 7, Section 2. And can I ask my staff to put it on the PowerPoint presentation, because I will refer to certain phrases. Again, because I am a true believer that every interpretation of this court must have a clear textual anchor. But on the other hand, the result of that textual anchor, the interpretation must be just. It cannot be that only just, no legal, but there must be legality as well as justness, okay, in any case. So Article 7, Section 2. These are the qualifications to become president, okay. So there is natural born, correct? Must be a registered voter, able to read and write, at least 40 years of age, and on the day of the election, 40 years, and a resident of the Philippines for at least 10 years immediately preceding. At least 10 years immediately preceding the elections, what does it qualify? At least 10 years immediately preceding the election.
That's
we
residence.
Said, look at the text, look at the phraseology, normative order, normative context. See, at least 10 years immediately preceding the election, what does it qualify?
The residence.
Does it qualify 40 years of age?
No, Your Honor.
No, cannot. Contradictory. Yes. What about able to read and write?
No, Your Honor. It's
at least 10 years prior to the election, able to read and write. That's not what it says. It just says able to read and write, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
So the candidate must be able to read and write on the day of the election, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Never mind if they cannot read and write the day before, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
I'm just exaggerating for emphasis, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes. So, 10 years qualifies residency but not citizenship. Is that not correct?
That's true, correct,
That's
Your Honor.
True.
They're independent concepts.
So, citizenship and residency are two different things, correct?
That's correct, Your
Honor. Yes. A citizen can be a resident of another country, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes. And a foreigner can be a resident in the Philippines.
That's correct, Your Honor.
From this, from that provision, is that
yes,
not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
So citizenship and residency are two different things, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
They may be related, but they are not one and the same.
Yes,
correct?
Your Honor.
Okay, by the way, residency for purposes of the election is domicile, correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Where is domicile in that provision?
Well, the word resident is used, but jurisprudence interprets that domicile.
Wait a minute. In 1987, was there already a doctrinal distinction between domicile and residency? In 1987, when this was passed, that was the year that I graduated, and you graduated earlier than me, and I think with honors,
yes.
If I'm not mistaken. But in any case, was there already a doctrinal distinction between residence and domicile?
For purposes of election law, there is no distinction, Your Honor.
Yes, and when the writers of the Constitution wrote the Constitution, they did not use domicile. They used residence. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And who said again, after the 87 Constitution, that it is domicile?
The Supreme Court, in various cases. Yes.
But it's not there. How can we put some words there that aren't there?
Well, it's part and parcel of the exercise of the power to interpret the Constitution.
Residence may not be your domicile. It may be a hotel room, for that matter, correct?
Yes, in the
when you go to Haro or Manila and you're not actually having your home there, then that's your residence for a while, but not
yes,
your domicile, correct?
I understand. In the civil code, they have a different concept of residence.
Yes. So in other words, the Supreme Court can interpret that based on the rationale of that provision. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes. And it's clear there that for any reasonable purpose, it will be absurd to say that it is residence, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Because if it is only residence, then the purpose of residency will not be complied with, correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
And what's the purpose of the residency
requirement? Well, the purpose is to make sure that the candidate is familiar with the conditions of the constituency, its problems, its the aspirations of its people.
How old is your client? How old is the petitioner?
68, she should be 40. 48 something or 50.
We are good in law, but not necessarily math.
Sorry to say, Your Honor.
47.
47.
Correct? Of the 47 years.
Yes, Your Honor.
How long has she stayed in the Philippines?
Since May 24, 2005.
Oh, when she was born, she was not here.
You mean to say immediately preceding the election?
Yes.
Well, she was born here, Your Honor, September 3, 1968.
Yes. Out of the 47 years, how many years has she been here?
At least
Let me put it another
years,
way.
Probably
how many 30. Years has she been in the United States?
From 1991 to 2005, Your Honor.
And I hope your assistants will help you. How many years is that?
It's around 15 years, Your Honor.
15 years?
Yes.
Of 47 years, what's the percentage?
That's probably about 20%, Your Honor.
You stated the purpose for residency, to be familiar with the conditions in the Philippines. By the way, when someone goes abroad, like in 1898, when the amendment in the U.S. Constitution was introduced with respect to natural-born citizenship, in 1898, when you are in a different country, you cannot communicate with your home country. Very difficult, correct? There
yes,
was
sir.
No internet then. There
yes.
was no Viber at yes. that time, correct?
Yes, sir.
Yes. In 1991, of course, the internet was alive. There were computers, there were telephones, there were television, etc. So they would have been in contact there. So 10 years immediately preceding the election, can this actually mean that it is not continuous?
Well, it would be continuous because
where does it say that it should be continuous?
Well, the Supreme Court said a person to maintain his residence does not have to be actually in the Philippines 24 hours a day or every day of the year.
We already said it's domicile. For domicile, must it be continuous 10 years?
Yes, Your Honor. Even if there are periods of absences, the concept of
where
domicile...
Where does it say continuous? Where is the qualifier continuous?
Well, that can be implied from the statement of the period itself, 10 years preceding.
I will relate it to the purpose that you said, to be familiar with the conditions in the Philippines. And of the 47 years that your client was alive, and continuing, she has been in the Philippines for more than two-thirds of her life.
That's correct.
Yes. Now, whether the two-thirds of her life definitely is more than 10 years, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Can that already comply with the provisions of the Constitution?
Well, our jurisprudence say that domicile or residence can be interrupted. It can be abandoned. That's why it would still be necessary to determine whether she can say she was domiciled here for a period of at least 10 years immediately preceding the election.
Because one theory presented by the respondent, and this one I need you to address, is that she missed it by a few months. Correct? Because it was in July of 2006, right?
Yes, Your Honor.
But that's 2 months of 47 years, or 2 months of two-thirds of 47. Correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, but in any case, you are saying, your position is that it must be continuous.
Well, continuous in the sense that even if there are periods of absences, there is always an intent to return, so the period would still be continuous.
Yes, immediately preceding such election. It did not say continuously for 10 years, immediately preceding the election. Does that matter?
I think the intent really is that the candidate should be able to show that immediately preceding the day of the elections, she should have resided here for 10 years.
Okay. Now, citizenship and residence, according to you, are different.
That's
so
correct.
For residents, there must be a 10-year continuous period before the elections.
That's correct, Your
That's
Honor.
Your position now. Okay?
Yes, Your Honor.
And residents, we mean domicile, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And you are not in a position now to argue that some of our doctrines should be expanded on the basis of contemporary circumstances. You are now sticking to those doctrines.
Yes, Your
Am
Honor.
Am I getting you correctly? Okay, now, with respect to citizenship, when must citizenship be present in order that a candidate be qualified?
Well, at least it should be at the time that the COC is filed, because a representation has to be made there that the candidate is natural-born citizen.
So that person must be a natural-born citizen at the day when they file the certificate of candidacy?
Yes, Your Honor.
What's your position with respect to your petitioner, to your client?
Well, at the time that she filed her COC, she is a natural-born citizen.
She was a citizen at least when she filed her COC, correct?
At least, Your Honor.
And now you're claiming that she was natural-born, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, let's look at citizenship. She used her American passport. She used her American passport. She used her American passport in 2005. Correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
The only time she stopped using her American passport was in 2011. I'm sorry, 2010, when she renounced her American citizenship. Is that not correct?
The last time she used her U.S. passport was March of 2010, Your Honor.
Yes. How is that relevant to the citizenship requirement? Is it relevant?
Well, because of the jurisprudence that a person who reacquires natural-born citizenship under RA 9225, who uses her passport after she files the sworn renunciation of the foreign citizenship, is deemed to recant.
Is she disqualified because of that?
In that case, she would be disqualified because her sworn renunciation.
No, not now. Your client is disqualified. We can finish this entire case right
now. Of course,
here.
She's not disqualified, Your Honor, because she never used her passport.
I ask you, what is the relevance of the use of the American passport with respect to the citizenship requirement in Article 7?
Well, the use of the U.S. passport will not recant or negate the oath of allegiance which she took on July 7, 2006.
No, but if you just looking at the qualification of being president, you said, upon the filing of a COC, and I assume this was in 2015, correct?
Yes.
She was, according to you, natural-born citizen.
Yes, Your Honor.
But the argument is that she used her Philippine passport in before 2011. Does that affect the citizenship requirement in Article 7 for your client? What's your position there?
It will not affect the citizenship, but it would disqualify her because use of the U.S. passport after she renounced U.S. citizenship can recant that renunciation, and that will disqualify her because under 9225, before she can run for public office.
So you're saying your client is disqualified?
Your Honor?
Your client is disqualified?
She's not disqualified because she never used her U.S. passport after she renounced her U.S. citizenship.
But you're saying now that because she used it, she can be disqualified for the Philippine election, presidential elections in 2016.
If she used it, Your Honor, after she renounced...
The facts of the case, is she disqualified?
She's not disqualified because
she never... But she used her American passport.
Well, before she officially renounced
her... So what is the relation of the use of the American passport in relation to her qualification of being president? I'm now confused.
There's no relationship based on the facts.
No relationship because...
Because she never used her U.S. passport.
Because according to you, the interpretation is, your position is, she must be Filipino and natural born at the time of the filing of the certificate of candidacy, correct?
She must be solely Filipino.
Okay. Is citizenship determinative of whether you can establish a domicile?
No, Your Honor.
Your jurisprudence?
The cases of Fermin, Coquilla, Caballero, which all say that citizenship and residence are independent
concepts. I want to go to Caballero because that's the latest case of this court.
And yes, Sir.
Correct? There, the candidate was able to reacquire Filipino citizenship. Is that correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Yes. But the reacquisition of Filipino citizenship does not start the period for domicile. Is that not correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
In fact, it was in that case where this whole court said that the acquisition of Filipino citizenship does not per se mean that he starts his residency. Is that not correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Yes. Therefore, clarifying that there is a difference between citizenship and residency, correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Yes. Although it was also in that case where the court, speaking through the ponente, also said that citizenship or the application for citizenship may be affected by may affect residency. Is that not correct? Because to apply for Canadian citizen in Caballero requires residency in Canada. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And within the relevant period, he was applying for Canadian citizenship. Is that not correct?
Well, the relevant period there, he had applied for Canadian citizenship and he had actually acquired Canadian citizenship.
Yes, and therefore the court held that because it cannot be shown that she already finished the residency requirement in Canada, therefore there was no residence in the Philippines. You can only have one residency. Is that not correct?
That's correct. Yes. Because there he never claimed that he reestablished his residence before reacquiring
citizenship. What's the situation with the petitioner? What was the situation? 10 years prior to 2016 election, was she applying for American citizenship? Or did she already have American citizenship?
She became a U.S. citizen in 1991, Your Honor.
So I need to be clear. 10 years prior to the election, she applying for American citizenship or did she already have American citizenship?
When she 10 years before, she was applying for, she's no longer. Your Honor, she maintained her U.S. citizenship. She was a U.S. citizen until 2001. She became a U.S. citizen in 2001. She remained a dual citizen until she renounced her U.S. citizenship October 20.
To become a U.S. citizen, what is the residency requirement?
I believe it is 5 years, Your Honor.
And the 5-year period before she was able to acquire American citizenship was when?
She became a U.S. citizen 2001, so
1996?
Yes, Your Honor.
If that is your computation, and if it's true that it's 5 years, not 10 years, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes. So therefore, when she was already coming back to the Philippines, in your theory, on May of 2005, she was already an American citizen, right?
She was an American citizen.
She didn't need to be a resident in order to maintain American citizenship. Is that not correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Can a German be domiciled in the Philippines?
I would think so, Your Honor.
Can a Balikbayan American also be domiciled in the Philippines?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, so therefore, there is this distinction. But what about the case of Coquilla?
Well, in Coquilla, I think in that case, he reacquired his Philippine citizenship, but claims that he had reestablished his residence even before. But he had nothing to show as evidence that he had actually reestablished himself here. So the court said all that he had to show was a community tax certificate that he had a Balikbayan permission, that he entered under the Balikbayan program. He had presented absolutely no evidence that he had actually relocated here. So the court said that dismissed his claim that he had reestablished his residence for purposes of elections.
Which came first, the Coquilla case or the Caballero case?
The Coquilla case, I believe, Your Honor.
And our doctrines, can they be qualified by the later precedent or the earlier one?
Well, both. I think Caballero reiterates Coquilla, but the similarity of both cases is that they do not really say that residents cannot be reestablished before reacquiring Philippine citizenship.
Okay. Perhaps in your memo, you explain why Caballero Coquilla Hapson is different from the case of your petitioner. And I want to move on because I do not want to consume too much time. Now, let's go to natural-born citizen. So there are two kinds of citizens here in the country, natural-born and naturalized. Am I categorizing it properly, or there is a third kind?
Well, there are two basic kinds only, the natural-born and the naturalized.
Where did we get natural-born?
Again,
where did we get the word natural-born?
Well, from the...
I mean, everybody, all humans are naturally born, correct?
Well,
and it's a legal concept. Where did we get it? Did we invent it, or is it transplanted?
Well, it was introduced in the 1973 Constitution. I believe the concept can have been borrowed from the U.S. Constitution, where the term natural-born is used,
okay,
but not in their nationality law.
Although, just to understand what this means, natural-born, not really mandatory on our part, can you tell us why the United States Constitution contains the word natural-born citizen?
I think even right after the Revolution, there were concerns about foreigners trying to occupy high offices, Your Honor. So there was an attempt to make sure that high positions would be reserved to...
The literature says that it was a single letter written by John Jay to George Washington, which contains the following: whether it would not be wise and reasonable to provide a strong check to the admission of foreigners into the administration of our national government, and to declare expressly that the commander-in-chief of the American army shall not be given to or devalued on any but a natural-born citizen. That's John Jay to George Washington, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes. John Jay became later on the Secretary of State. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And it was this same Secretary of State, John Jay, that provided advice to their negotiators in the Treaty of Paris. Is this not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And John Jay sent a letter to the representatives of the Americans in the Treaty of Paris to make sure that there is a distinction between civilized and non-civilized Filipinos. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yet. But for now, we are saying that they were concerned about natural-born, non-natural-born, being the commander-in-chief of their army. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
By the way, in the United States, what is to be natural-born?
A person who is born within U.S. territory is deemed natural-born, Your Honor.
In 1898, they introduced an amendment defining what natural-born is, correct? And in that amendment, they said that natural-born is anyone who is born there or is born of parents, mother or father, in a different part of the globe. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, let me make this very clear. Two Filipinos go to Hawaii, give birth to a son in Hawaii, a daughter in Hawaii. Correct? Now, that daughter of two Filipino mothers and fathers, what can be the citizenship of that daughter?
Under Philippine law, the daughter would be Filipino. Natural-born Filipino.
Under American law?
A natural-born American. Provided,
wait,
of course, I think there's a
residence. You are saying that the daughter born of two Filipino parents,
I'm sorry,
just because they were born in Hawaii, can later on become the commander-in-chief of the U.S. Armed Forces.
Well, based on my understanding of American law, which is quite limited, since the daughter was born within U.S. territory, she would be a U.S. citizen.
Because they're jus soli, right?
Yes, Your Honor.
And if she was born there, she can become the chief of staff or even the president, who is the commander-in-chief of the strongest army in the world, correct?
I believe so, Your Honor.
The one we hope will protect us in the West Philippine Sea. Don't answer that. But the point there is that this person can become the commander-in-chief, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
That's in the United States of America.
Yes, Your Honor.
Correct? So what protects them against foreigners?
Well,
will she automatically become the president of the United States?
Again, I'm not...
Well, she has to defeat Trump. She has to defeat Hillary Clinton or Rubio or Ted Cruz or Bernie Sanders, for that matter, right? Or Obama and whoever, correct?
Yes,
an election is going to be held, correct?
Yes, Your
Honor. So the protection that their forces and the entire country will be under the management of only someone who they think is loyal will be dependent not on a qualification in the Constitution but the election. Is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
But the Philippines is different, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes, in the Philippines, we have clear provisions on citizenship. Is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. Let's just make this sure, because I want to understand the rationale of natural born. Being natural born assures your loyalty to the Republic, true or false?
No, Your Honor, although that is the premise of the requirement that certain high officials should be naturally born.
If it is not the premise anymore, and this is a court sitting today, will we pretend that that premise is true?
Well, that is the premise for the requirement of natural-born citizenship. But if the question is whether or not, in fact, natural-born citizenship ensures loyalty, I would say...
Is that a scientific fact? That natural-born does not assure loyalty? Do you have evidence to show that there are natural-born politicians who are not loyal? Don't answer that. But my next question would be, being a naturalized Filipino will assure that that person has the tendency of being more disloyal than a natural-born citizen.
That is, again, the premise of the requirement
now,
for natural-born citizenship.
Dura lex sed lex may be to read the law, but on the other hand, the Supreme Court is tasked to make sure that the rationale is still there. Although the text is there, we have to read it in such a way that it covers a rational reason, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes, and perhaps you can help us. Why do you think that there is a requirement for natural-born citizenship?
Well, I think the rationale there is precisely the premise that natural-born citizens would be inclined, would probably be more loyal or would demonstrate allegiance to the government than citizens who are not natural-born.
Okay. You know what peninsulares are? Peninsulares, during the Spanish colonial period. Spaniards here,
yes,
who were born in Spain, insulares.
Yes, Your Honor.
Spaniards born here, correct?
Yes.
You had indios, ilustrados, caciques, mestizos, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
You had gradations of citizenship, correct?
That's correct.
And these gradations of citizenship was the cause of our colonial oppression, or part of it, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
When the Americans came, they created a classification. Christianized and non-Christianized tribes, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Christianized and Moros, right? Earlier than that, before the Spanish established their civil government here, there was Cristianos and Paganos. Is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes. Now, when we said that we should look at all the provisions in the Constitution to make sure that we are correctly interpreting the provisions on citizenship, should we not also take into consideration our colonial past? That we have to prevent a situation where there are second and third class citizens in this country, more than what the Constitution requires?
No, Your Honor. Classification based, classification on that basis, I think, will not be permissible.
So in citizenship, we can create more subclassifications other than natural born and naturalized.
I don't think so, Your Honor.
We cannot.
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes, and our colonial history should inform us, this court, that we should try to prevent the oppression of the marginalized. Is that correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Am I reading too much into our history? But then you have Article 2 of our Constitution, right? And Article 2, Section 1 states, would you remember? The Philippines is a democratic and republican state. Sovereignty resides in the people and all governmental authority emanates from them. People is unqualified, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
We have the first characteristic of citizenship, singularity, right?
Yes,
that
Your Honor.
All people are citizens, correct?
That's correct.
And then we go to Article 2, Section 11. Can we flash it? It says, the state values the dignity of every human person and guarantees full respect for human rights, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Is this in the Constitution?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes. I'm making an argument, not looking at the proceedings, but for you and the respondents to address. Because whatever doctrine we come out here will be doctrine with all its implications. And therefore, I want it to be covered by all the memoranda. It says here, dignity of every human person and guarantees full respect for human rights, correct?
That's correct,
now,
Your Honor.
Is the ability to be able to govern yourself and your community, the opportunity to have that opportunity, okay, is that part of human rights?
Yes, Your Honor, the right to run for office is a recognized right.
Suffrage, etc. So therefore, there is that specific provision. Article 2, Section 14. Role of women, fundamental equality before the law of men and women, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Of course, you know that in many places, the right of women to vote were delayed, right? Even in the Philippines, it was only given in 1941. There is this movie now, The Suffragettes, which details what happened in England, correct? That
yes,
women had to be oppressed, force-fed. They had to undergo a revolution of their own in order to vote. But now we have this. Okay, as a matter of fact, if you follow the U.S. Constitution, there is Dred Scott. Remember that case? Dred Scott said that there are slaves, but they are not persons, and therefore they do not have citizenship. Elk versus Williams, Native Americans cannot become citizens. Gonzales versus Williams, standing case, Puerto Ricans are U.S. citizens, but not Americans. They are in unincorporated territory, which, by the way, will be our condition if we did not gain our independence. They are also covered by the Treaty of Paris, correct? So
yes,
our constitution here guarantees that there will never be, or we hope that when we interpret the constitution, there is no person that is marginalized. Am I correct in saying that?
Yes, Your Honor.
But, let's look at the last provision, Section 14. 13. Vital role of the youth in nation building shall promote their well-being, etc., so that they can participate in public affairs, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
A foundling can be youth.
Yes, Your Honor.
Correct? And of course, a foundling can grow up and become an adult, correct? But
yes,
while they are children and while they are teenagers, the Constitution now does not make an ageist classification. They can participate unless there are reasonable classifications or reasons or rationale to be able to do so. Is that not correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Okay, so now let us go to an argument. The burden of proof is with your client because she wants to be the president of this republic to prove that she has all the qualifications to become president.
That's false, Your Honor. Anyone who accuses a candidate that is disqualified has the burden of proof to establish the disqualification. So,
why is that false? Isn't that reasonable?
It's not reasonable, Your Honor, because
you know,
it is...
You know the power of a president. The president can remake this entire court. The next president. 10 retiring justices within the next term. What power? The next president will appoint the ombudsman in 2017. The next president will probably appoint COMELEC. I'm not sure. or Civil Service Commission, correct? The next president determines the chief of staff. What awesome powers that president has, correct? Therefore, for you to put your name to the public in order for the public to choose, then you have the burden of evidence, correct?
It does not follow, Your Honor. The importance of the position has nothing to do with rules on presumption and burden of proof. I believe that petitioner, even if she's running for a high position, even if she's a foundling, is entitled to the application of ordinary rules on burden of proof and presumptions.
Okay. Maybe cover that again in your memoranda, because there is a strong argument coming from the respondents that the burden should be with your petitioner, and you are now saying that it is not. By the way, has there been proof to show that your client is a foreigner?
No, Your Honor.
I mean, is she from China?
She's not from China.
Mexico, Pakistan?
No evidence at all that she or her parents are foreigners, Your Honor.
At the time that she was born, was there evidence presented in COMELEC? Even assuming that you had the burden of proof, I just want to know, was there any evidence presented by the petitioners in the COMELEC case proving that at birth, your petitioner did not have Filipino citizenship?
Absolutely no proof. The sole basis for their position she's not natural born is that she's a foundling.
Okay, so if I look at the issues from my perspective, it now boils down to who had the burden of proof, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And it all boils down to the very concept of what natural born is, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And it all boils down to the values that we need to protect in determining what is natural born. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes. And I hope that will be also covered by the respondents, if that is the correct frame in terms of looking at this this particular issue. Now let's look at the definition of natural born in Article 4, Section 3. Natural born citizen, okay, by the way, this is Section 2, and Section 2 has the word natural born, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Section 1, if we can flash it, enumerates the classes of citizens but does not define natural born. Am I correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
So when we look at the definition of natural born, we go first to Section 2, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And Section 2 clearly states that natural born citizens are those citizens of the Philippines from birth without having to perform any act to acquire or perfect citizenship. Is that not correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. When your client was born, what was the citizenship of your client?
She was presumed to be natural born.
Citizenship.
Yes, Your Honor.
We are trying to see whether it is natural born. Natural born means at birth, she was Filipino. What is the citizenship of your client when she was born?
Filipino, Your Honor.
Why?
Because she was presumed to be a Filipino at birth.
You see, this is my problem. Where do we get that presumption? I need to anchor it on something. Where can we anchor it? I realize that this was your response also to Justice Del Castillo last time, that there is such a thing as presumed citizenship. But maybe to some of us, presumed citizenship is too iffy, too ambiguous, and too tenuous a link. By the way, what is citizenship?
It's a membership in a political society and entails certain rights and duties vis-a-vis the citizen.
Rights and duties which
government
can ripen to privileges and power, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
It's a powerful concept because you are a member of a political community which can ripen to your becoming a barangay captain or a justice of the Supreme Court or a legislator, etc., correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
So it must be something that is taken very seriously, correct?
That's correct, Your
yes.
Honor.
So again, what is your basis for saying that your client upon birth
there
was...
two bases, Your Honor.
Okay.
One is that there are presumptions of law based on international law that she should be considered natural born. And then there's the presumption of fact. The place where she was found, together with other circumstances, constitutes circumstantial evidence that more probably than not, she was born of Filipino parents.
Okay, because you refer to Section 1, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And Section 1 says, father or mother.
Yes, Your Honor.
Were citizen. By the way, does that provision require that you name the father or you name the mother?
what the provision does not say that you have to name the father or the mother, Mother, Your Honor.
In other words, we come to an ambiguous area, a margin, in terms of reading the text of the Constitution. Normally, or in general cases, I'm sorry if I use the word normal because I think foundlings should also be normal, but in general, in most cases, you just name your father or you name your father in order to become, to show that you are natural born. Because upon naming that person, immediately you have a father or a mother who is a citizen of this republic, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
But in this particular case, the case is different. You cannot name the father or the mother. Is that not correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
But can you prove that the father or mother is most likely a Filipino?
Yes, Your Honor, by circumstantial
evidence.
Have you done
so?
Or in lieu of evidence, by presumptions.
Have you done so?
Yes, Your Honor.
Did you present evidence in the COMELEC?
We did cite, Your Honor, what we consider circumstantial evidence.
Did COMELEC receive factual evidence?
Yes, Your Honor. The main.
Did you present exhibits and witnesses?
Well, the main circumstantial evidence is the place of birth. The fact that she was born in Iloilo.
Again, this is something serious because the position in some instances is that the COMELEC is the one that determines the questions of fact and we are determining the questions of law.
Yes.
And if COMELEC did not determine the question of fact, then there is some arbitrariness at this point. So my question is, were the facts laid down in the COMELEC case? Meaning to say, was evidence presented so that it can be inferred that there was such a presumption or the evidence tended to show that your client was Filipino of Filipino parentage?
As I said, we relied on presumptions of law and then we relied on the fact that the place where she was found is itself circumstantial evidence that more probably than not she was born of Filipino mothers or Filipino parents.
More likely than not? And what is that? Because it's in Haro?
Well, we can take judicial notice of the fact and the COMELEC code that the overwhelming majority of the population are Filipinos, that only a small minority are foreigners. So projecting that, more probably than not, her parents
okay,
were
are
Filipinos.
We saying that all foundlings found in the Philippines are presumed to be Filipino?
Yes, Your Honor.
Really?
Yes.
So when a foundling is found in, let us say, Olongapo, okay, or Club Janhay in Baguio City, you know that place, right?
Yes, Your Honor.
Or in Clark or in Subic, that we immediately presume it as Filipino.
Yes, that is the premise of the Domestic Adoption Act.
If a foundling is found in the British International School or the Japanese International School, or for that matter, I don't know the other international schools in this republic, international school itself. So we are saying that jus soli applies. Because it is found in the territory of the republic, then therefore it is presumed to be Filipino.
No, we are still applying the jus sanguinis principle because we're saying the fact that the foundling is found here.
If the foundling is found within the embassy of Pakistan or India or Mexico.
That might be, that would be a different situation because
so are we
then
saying,
there's a question
as
of,
a general rule, is it your position that all foundlings, whenever it's found in the Philippine territory, will immediately be Filipino?
That is the presumption established by our laws, the Domestic Adoption Act, the rules on adoption promulgated by the Supreme Court.
Or would it be better to say that the presumption will only come if there is enough evidence to show that most likely the father or the mother is a Filipino citizen?
The only basis required by law is a foundling certificate. The place itself where the foundling is found raises the inference that more probably than not, the foundling was born of Filipino parents.
Okay. To prove that that person is not natural born, is it enough to prove that the father is not Filipino?
It would be necessary to prove that either parent is a foreigner.
So,
or both, I'm sorry,
would it be
that both
to
parents
prove that
are foreigners.
The father is not Filipino.
Both parents must be shown to be foreigners.
Just yes or no. Is it enough to prove that the father is not Filipino?
No, Your Honor.
The mother is not Filipino?
No, Your Honor.
Is it necessary to prove that the father and mother are not Filipino?
Yes, Your Honor.
Again, did you present evidence to prove that either father or mother are Filipino?
No, Your Honor, because the burden of proof is not on us.
Was there enough evidence to show that the father and mother were not Filipino?
No evidence at all.
Were facts presented in the COMELEC? In other words, was there a presentation of evidence and the evidence properly, in an adversarial proceeding, properly cross-examined in order for the COMELEC divisions to be able to determine which fact is true and which fact is not, and the proper inference to be made from the evidence?
The proceeding was summary, but our evidence consisted mainly in the foundling certificate.
So you're not taking the position that there is arbitrariness on the part of the COMELEC in the sense that the facts were not laid out. So you're accepting that it was summary and it was legitimate that the facts were considered the way it was.
Well, even if it were summary, Your Honor, we're not questioning the procedures there, but we're questioning the fact that they did not give the proper weight or the proper significance to the fact that there's a founding certificate, that there's a decree of adoption, which can be premised only on the acceptance that she is a Filipino.
Okay. Let's go to another point. There is a very intricate argument made by Dean Amado Valdez, among others, in his comment. And this is that there are two kinds of, there are two stages in Republic Act 9225. Before the law became law in 2003, it was reacquisition of citizenship. After it became law, then dual citizenship was already allowed, and therefore it was not reacquisition, I think it was repatriation, if I'm not mistaken, correct? Your client reacquired Filipino citizenship.
Yes, Your Honor.
And based upon the definition, because there was an act to reacquire Filipino citizenship, she may have been natural born before, but now she is not.
Yes, Your Honor.
You agree?
I disagree, Your Honor. The distinction between reacquiring and retention is not really a significant one, because the policy of the law is that whether the Filipino lost his citizenship before 2003 or after 2003, the policy of the law is that he shall not be deemed to have lost his Philippine citizenship.
The policy is found where?
I believe it's Section 2, Your Honor.
Section 2 in 9225. Okay. Again, I will need that to be covered covered more clearly. What is a visa?
A visa is an official document allowing a foreigner or alien to enter and stay in the Philippines.
With a balikbayan visa, or is it a balikbayan visa?
It's a visa free program, Your Honor.
Okay, so when a balikbayan comes, there is no visa, correct?
Yes, but the program itself envisages that there is a permission given to the returning Filipino to enter without a formal visa.
Is it legal for a foreigner under a balikbayan program to establish domicile in the Philippines?
Yes, Your Honor. For purposes of election, I believe we follow the election laws and not immigration laws.
Is it not a violation of Republic Act 6768?
I don't believe so, Your Honor.
Please cover that in your memoranda. I just want to make sure whether it is legal for somebody who enters visa-free under the Balikbayan program to be able to establish their residence here. And is it also legal for a person with a Balikbayan visa or visa-free entry as a Balikbayan to actually apply under Republic Act 9225?
Yes, Your Honor. In fact, he can apply without actually entering the Philippines.
Okay. Again, cover in your memo the concept of a Balikbayan visa, and I need more explanation regarding why your client did not apply for an immigrant visa.
Yes, I can explain that, Your Honor, that the requirement of a permanent resident visa or non-quota returning former Filipino visa would apply only if the intent is to reacquire citizenship through naturalization under CA 63.
What is your proof that your client actually established residence here in May?
May 24, 2005, she came home, relocated herself together with her children. She re-enrolled her children here. After withdrawing them from American schools, she acquired property here where eventually her family would live.
How old were her children when she enrolled them here?
Again, Your Honor?
How old were the children when she enrolled them here?
Two were re-enrolled here. The youngest was not of school age.
The eldest was?
I think she was already in high school, Your Honor.
But you see, certain families can afford to send their children to study abroad.
That's correct, Your Honor.
Yes, and is that truly an indicator of the intent to establish domicile here? Was that an intent? Did that actually signify an intent?
The intent really was for them to relocate here.
No, if it's only the fact of enrolling, and if it is true that other families can send people, their children abroad to study, can it prove that they actually wanted to establish domicile?
Yes, because they actually sold their residence in the U.S.
Also, perhaps you're saying that it's not that fact alone, but several other things.
Yes, Your Honor. Among a lot of other things, they dispose of their assets there. Remember, they're not the typical balikbayan who come in with luggages and balikbayan box. They came in with containers full of their furniture.
What is your proof that they came in with container vans?
Communications, Your Honor, with Victory Van International, where it is stated that they brought home 28,000 pounds
of counsel,
assets.
But counsel, they left properties abroad. They left properties abroad, which meant, perhaps, that they wanted to return there.
The fact of the matter is that their residents, they live here, Your Honor. If they go back there for short vacations, that does not negate the fact that they have relocated here.
Are you familiar with the case of Hallover versus Comelec?
I can't remember the facts now, Your Honor.
This is the case of running for a position in Toledo City, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
The court held that he has fully established residence in Toledo City, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Did he actually buy property and reside there? Or was he only renting at that point?
I'm not sure of the facts, Your Honor, but I believe to establish residence, one does not have to buy. It's enough that he can actually live in rented property or live with a relative, Your Honor. Okay. And that will not negate the fact that residence is established.
Last question. I think I took too much time. Certificate of candidacy for the Senate. Okay. What is the residency requirement for the Senate?
2 years, Your Honor.
2 years. What did she put in the certificate of candidacy?
6 years and 6 months, Your Honor.
6 years and 6 months?
Yes.
Did that comply with the requirement for the Senate?
More than complied with the
did
requirement.
Did she submit that certificate only for purposes of the Senate?
Yes, Your Honor.
Did she intend to submit that certificate to run for president today?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. Finally, there is this Latin maxim, fiat justitia ruat cello. Would you be able to translate that?
No, Your Honor. I'm sorry, Your Honor.
Do justice, though the heavens may fall. Correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Yes. And between dura lex, sed lex, vox populi, there are middle grounds, right?
That's correct, Your Honor.
But you have to read the provision of the law to look at your history, to right the unjust, to not oppress, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And this is fiat justitia ruat cello, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
But it applies to your case.
No, Your Honor, because in this situation, the law
so
would seem
justice,
to be hard.
This court must side with the respondents.
Your Honor, the law may seem to be hard only because COMELEC has unreasonably applied or interpreted the law, Your Honor.
To do justice, which side will we side with in your position? From your perspective, to do justice.
True justice should be with petitioner, Your Honor.
Your petitioner. But of course, that's the same argument made by the respondents, correct?
That's what they claim, Your Honor.
Okay, thank you. I have no further questions.
Justice Scarpio.
Just a few questions, counsel. In 1930, the Hague Convention was signed. And how many states signed that convention, Council?
The 1930 Hague Convention, Your Honor?
1930.
I believe 37...
1930 Hague Convention. It's here in your 108, page 108 of your pleading.
Pardon me, Your Honor. Is it the 1930 Hague Convention?
1930 Hague Convention.
Yes.
So how many parties signed that convention?
I believe
how many states?
37 states, Your Honor, signed it.
32 states signed that. And at that time, how many members were there in the League of Nations?
I believe it was 73. So almost half or close to half signed the convention.
No, there were 54 members of the League of Convention in 1930. 32 signed the 1930 Hague Convention. Is that correct? That's about it. Okay. In 1934, when Rojas made his humble opinion, let me recall, state again what he said. Rojas said during the deliberations of the CONCON at the time, my humble opinion is that by international law, the principle that children or people born in a country of unknown parents are citizens of this nation is recognized, and it is not necessary to include a provision on the subject exhaustively. That was his humble opinion. 1934, he stated that during the deliberations of the 1934 Constitutional Convention, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Now, in 1934, when he said that, how many states have ratified the 1930 Hague Convention?
At the time of the adoption of the 1930 Hague Convention, I believe there are 32 signatories. There were 32 state signatories, Your Honor.
Wait, the Hague Convention was signed in 1930, and there is a provision there that it takes effect. It enters into force when 10 states have ratified it.
That's correct, Your Honor.
Okay. Now, in 1934, the convention had not entered into force yet, because the convention entered into force in 1937. In 1937, 10 countries ratified, so that made the convention effective. So in 1934, when the CONCON delegates deliberated on natural-born citizen foundlings, there was the convention of the Hague Convention had not entered into force yet.
Your Honor, if I may raise 2 points.
Now, my question is, do you know the number of countries that ratified the convention as of 1934 when Delegate Rojas made that remark?
I don't have that figure, Your Honor.
Okay, I'll give it to you. 7. That's why in 1934, the convention had not yet entered into force. It entered into force in 1937. When did the Constitution take effect?
1935, I believe.
1935.
Yes, Your Honor.
So when the Constitution took effect, the Hague Convention had not entered into force yet, correct?
That's true, but that's beside the point, Your Honor, because...
Wait. I'm just asking you questions. Okay. So, when the convention took effect in 1937, 10 states ratified the convention, correct?
That's true, Your Honor.
Okay. Now, how many members of the UN, of the League of Nations were there in 1937?
There were 74 sovereign states in 1937.
Sovereign states. That
yes,
all were members of the League of Nations. How many were members of the League of Nations?
I don't have that figure, Your Honor.
54. Was the United States ever a member of the League of Nations?
No, but its nationality law reflects the
yes,
provisions
my
of the
question,
Convention.
Council, is was the U.S. ever a member of the League of Nations? No, it was never a member. Was the Commonwealth of the Philippines ever a member of the League of Nations?
No, in fact, the Philippines never signed this convention,
okay.
Your Honor.
So, in 1937, when the convention took effect, entered into force, only 10 countries have ratified it. Correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. 10 countries out of 54 members of the League of Nations, what is that percentage?
Probably 12% or 15%, Your Honor.
Yes. It's just the percentage, 10 over 54, what's that? That's 18.5%. But there were at that time 74 states, sovereign states. Many states did not join the League of Nations. The Philippines Commonwealth Government did not join. The U.S. did not join. So there were 74 independent states at the time. So 10 out of 74, what is the percentage? 13.5%. So only 13.5% of states had ratified the convention at that time in 1937. Okay? Let's go, because I'm bringing this up because in your pleading, page 109, you said here that the 1930 Hague Convention had 37 state signatories or 50% of existing states in 1930. 50%. Okay. In 1930, not a single state has ratified the convention. In 1934, only 7. So I do not know where you got this 50%, because you're saying in 1937 states. What year was this?
1930. At the time of the adoption, Your Honor, there were 74 sovereign states. There were 37 signatories.
Signatories, but signatories doesn't make the convention effective. It's the ratification.
Your Honor, we're not invoking the convention as a treaty to which we are a party, but as a consolidation of generally accepted principles of international law. So these figures are irrelevant, Your Honor.
You're even in a shaker ground.
I don't think so, Your Honor.
Because customary law, the rule on customary international is more strict than conventional international law.
I don't believe so,
Your
Honor.
So you are saying that in 1930, there were 37 states that had in their internal law a rule that foundlings are deemed to be natural-born citizens of the country where they are found. Is that what you're saying?
No, Your Honor. May I just... We are not invoking this convention.
That's why. You're saying you're invoking the practice because you said there were 37 signatories to the convention.
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, there were actually 32 signatories to the convention. Okay, let's assume you're correct, 37. Are you saying that all those 37 states had internal law, domestic law, saying that foundlings in their country are deemed to be natural-born citizens?
Again, that's beside the point, Your Honor. The fact of the matter is that we are not invoking this as a treaty entered into force.
Customary international law becomes customary if a large number of states adopt that law as their own.
Not necessarily.
So my question is, all these 37 states that signed in 1930, did they adopt that particular provision as part of their internal domestic law?
There are two kinds of generally accepted principles of international law. International customary law as evidenced by general practice, or general principles of law recognized by civilized nations. And what is general practice? It doesn't mean majority. It doesn't mean universal practice. It means only practice covering an extensive area followed by a representative number of states. Now, with respect,
my question, Council, is all these 37 states that you say signed that convention, did they actually adopt that principle as part of their internal law?
I'm not in a position to say, Your Honor.
You are not in a position to state. So therefore, you cannot say it is state practice at that time.
No, I can still say, Your Honor.
Yeah, but a state may not actually adopt a certain principle, but it signs a convention stating that principle. That happens when it's a new principle. So my question is, did the 37 states that signed the convention actually practice that already?
I'm not in a position to say, but
you are
what
not
I can
in a
say
position
is
to
that,
stay.
That in eventually, Your Honor, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which affirmed the principle in the 1930 Hague Convention through the right to a nationality, was unanimously adopted by all members
yes,
of the General Assembly.
That Universal Declaration said every citizen has a right to acquire a nationality, correct?
No, right to a nationality.
Yes, a right to a nationality. Does it say natural born?
It doesn't matter, Your
Honor. It
doesn't
say natural born.
The concept of natural born cannot be expected to be discussed in a treaty because that's a matter of local law or Philippine law.
Matter of constitutional law.
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. And our constitution says you must be a natural born before you can run for president, correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
So we have to follow our constitution, correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Okay. Okay. Let's go to 1968. When was the petitioner born?
1968, September
okay.
3, 1968.
In 1968, Your Honor. How many countries have ratified the Hague Convention?
22, Your Honor.
22. In 1968, how many were the members of the United Nations?
I don't have that figure.
193 members. So 22 over 193, that's 11.4%, correct?
Yes, but again, Your Honor, that's beside the point because general practice means does not mean majority. It does
yes,
not
so
mean
you are saying
universal.
That general practice can be 11%. That's what you're saying.
Yes, if it is extensive over a wide area and is representative. Furthermore, Your Honor, I think the Supreme Court has not interpreted generally accepted principles of international law only as international customary law. The Supreme Court also considers principles in treaties to which the Philippines is not a party as generally accepted principle of international law if they are aligned with certain basic principles in our constitution, like right to equality, right
what
against discrimination.
What does the constitution say? That we adopt the generally accepted principles of international law as part of the law of the land, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Generally accepted principles of international law. It doesn't say customary international law. Why?
Precisely, Your Honor, because in our jurisprudence, generally accepted principles of international law is not limited to international customary law. It includes general principles of law recognized by civilized nations.
Okay. General principles of international law, we have already a decision there, Sandigan, Ramos versus Sandigan, includes customary international law.
As part of the...
Yes, so the broader concept is generally accepted principles of international law.
Yes, Your Honor.
You are saying that 11% of the countries would represent generally accepted principles of international law. That's what you're saying.
Yes, Your Honor. In fact, in Rason versus Tagites, evidence of general practice consisted in evidence of regional practice or practice of the United States solely.
Now, does the Constitution say that generally accepted regional principles of law are part of the law of the land? It does not. It said.
It was the Supreme Court itself which said that in Rason versus Tagitis, Your Honor.
Regional? There are also regional principles of international law. There are universal principles of international law. What does the Constitution refer to?
Generally accepted principles of international
yes,
law.
Generally, yes, generally, and that has been understood to be total, not regional.
No, Your Honor.
So you're saying that
it
refers to regional?
Yes.
Oh, that's something else.
It's
so can you write it, explain that in your memo, that regional principles of international law bind the Philippines? Because there are many regional principles of international law that we don't want to follow.
Our proposition is that generally accepted principles of international law can be based on a regional treaty or a regional practice. For
no.
example, in the case of Mijares versus Ranada, the question there was whether or not the Convention on the Recognition and Enforcement of Foreign Judgments would be enforced here. there were only no more than 14 states which had mainly the members of the European Common Market which had adopted it. But the Supreme Court said this is generally accepted principle of international law. It is even consistent with our own law.
Okay, you explain why you believe that regional principles of international law will bind the Philippines, because there are many regional principles of international law we don't want to follow.
Well, it is okay. A selective process, Your Honor.
Let's go to residents. Your petitioner came here in May of 2005, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And became dual citizen in July of 2006.
July 7, 2006.
Okay. Between May of 2005 and July of 2006, what did she do in the Philippines?
Well, they had, from May 24, they were living here already. Initially, they were living with her mother. Her children were already here.
So you consider her as a resident already at the time?
For purposes of election law, she was a resident here because the Philippines was already her domicile.
So you considered her a resident alien during this period? Because she was still an American, correct, during this period?
Yes, until May.
She was a resident alien, that's your position. As a resident alien, you must file income tax return, correct?
That's true, Your Honor.
Did she file income tax return for that period?
I presume she did, Your Honor.
Can you submit that to the court? That she filed income tax return for that period, because that will establish that she planned to reside.
Not necessarily, Your Honor.
Okay. Anyway, you said that you believe she did file, so you submit a copy. You can redact it. Just you remove all the figures, blacken them, and just put there the date of receipt by the Bureau of Internal Revenue that she filed an income tax return for the years 2005 and 2006. Okay.
We will, Your Honor, advise her as to her rights with respect to this request. Then
yes,
we will respond.
You can blacken everything, all the figures. I just want to see that stamp received by the BIR.
Well, she has rights of confidentiality, so
okay,
I cannot submit,
you.
Your Honor.
If you want to, if you don't want to submit it, it's okay. But since you said that she probably filed, then you submit it if she probably filed.
I said I would presume, but it depends on whether or not she had income, whether she was a source of income here, Your Honor. So I will have to discuss this with her, Your Honor.
Okay. So you said she had, during the last oral argument, she said that she came here under a balikbayan visa.
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. Under the balikbayan program was established by law, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And under that law, it says that the purpose of the law is to encourage former Filipinos to come and visit. Those are the words. Come and visit the motherland. Come and visit the motherland, quote and unquote. Now, so a balikbayan is actually a visitor, correct?
That's not true, Your Honor. The balikbayan law was eventually amended.
The same. It was amended, and it still contained that section 1.
No, Your Honor. It emphasized the fact that a balikbayan program is a reintegration program. In fact, there are provisions there to make the balikbayan a reliable member of the community. There are provisions there to provide them livelihood programs, entrepreneurship training.
Yes, livelihood. It provides livelihood because the balikbayan program covered also OFWs.
It covers everyone who qualifies for the balikbayan,
yes,
Your Honor.
It covers OFWs. It covers former natural-born citizens, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
And so when you come here, the government will help you to learn some skills, correct?
Yes, because the intent is to reintegrate you, to become part of the community, Your Honor.
No, the intent is so that you will develop skills so you can go abroad and even earn more.
No, Your Honor, the purpose was to reintegrate, to make the balikbayan a member of the community,
okay.
Your Honor.
Can you cite to me section 1 of the amendment? Section 1 of Republic Act 9174. Section
Section 1 of Republic Act numbered 6768 is hereby amended to read as follows. Section 1, Balikbayan Program. The Balikbayan Program is hereby instituted under the administration of the Department of Tourism to attract and encourage overseas Filipinos to come and visit their motherland.
Okay.
This is in recognition of their contribution to the economy of the country through the foreign exchange inflow and revenues that they generate.
Okay, it means, it says, to encourage them to come and visit their motherland.
But you have,
now, when you have all, you travel often abroad, correct?
That's correct, Your Honor.
So you see the sign, residents, and then visitors. Visitors are not residents, correct?
Your Honor, I think we have to read Section 1 in conjunction with other provisions
so
of the law.
So what are those provisions?
Which clearly says that the Balikbayan Program is a reintegration program designed to make the Balikbayan not only transient visitors, but members of the community.
If you have a Balikbayan visa, can you work? Is that authority for you to get employment in the Philippines?
But that's beside the point. The question only is whether she could establish her residence, Your Honor. Why would we inquire as to whether
a Balikbayan visa, you are not authorized to work, correct? It's not a work permit. It's not a working visa, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
It's not.
But
are you, is that authority to engage in business in the Philippines, a Balikbayan visa?
Well, I cannot say that at this point in time. But again, that's beside the point. The question solely is whether or not she could establish her residence.
Yeah, but if you establish your residence, you must have some livelihood.
No, Your Honor, we follow only the standards provided for in our election law,
now,
which is physical presence.
Why does the Bureau of Immigration require a former natural-born citizen, if he wants to reside here, he must fill up a form specifically for those who are formerly natural-born citizens but are still aliens and they want to reside here? They have to fill up a special form.
Yes, Your Honor.
Did she fill that up?
I suppose so, Your Honor, when she came in.
Can you submit that? Because the last time I asked you that question last week, you said she did not fill it up.
No, what I said was that she did not. Did she register? She get a resident? Did she get an ACR? I think that was your question, Your Honor.
No, I also asked. I flashed it in the screen.
She did not get that because it was not necessary.
Oh, that is your. That's what I'm asking now. Did she fill up that form?
I did not understand your question. My answer now is no, she did not, Your Honor.
She did not fill up that form. That was your answer before.
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. Thank you, Counsel. That's all.
Justice De Castro.
Just a few questions from the counsel for the senator. Will you state in more specific terms the principle of international law that you are relying upon? You've been speaking in general terms that everyone should have a nationality, but we need to find out from you the specific principle of international law that you are referring to and what is your basis. What are the sources? What are the sources of the principles of international law, whether it's customary or not? What is your source? You have to identify your source. There are so many sources. The treaties of learned scholars in international law, decisions of international tribunal, conventions incorporating this customary international law into convention. What is specifically your source? And you state in precise terms the general principle of international law that you are relying upon.
Yes. The principle of international law which we're relying upon, Your Honor, is that stated in the 1930 Hague Convention and the 1961 Convention on Statelessness, which, if I may sum them up, accords to a foundling the presumption that she is born of citizens of the country where she is found. Now, what is my basis for saying that the 1930 Hague Convention constitutes a generally accepted principle of international law? By intent, it was a codification of international law principles on nationality. although we were not signatories to it, and although only 22 states ratified it, the 1930 Hague Convention was referred to and applied in various advisory opinions of the Permanent Court of International Justice, which involved states which were not even signatories or parties to the Hague Convention. Even our own publicists in international law, like Salonga, Defensor Santiago, Justice Kokia, invoked the 1930 Hague Convention when addressing nationality issues. But more than that, the right provided for in the 1930 Hague Convention was affirmed in the UN Declaration on the Rights of the Child and the Universal Declaration on Human Rights, which accord to a child or to a foundling the right to a nationality from birth. Now, this provision or right in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was in turn given effect in the Convention on Reduction of Statelessness. Why do I say that the Convention on Reduction of Statelessness constitutes generally accepted principles of international law? Quite apart from the fact that 60 countries ratified it, and 60 had in fact followed it through their legislation, the principles provided for there are consistent with our own principles embodied in our constitution, like the right to equality, the right against self, the right against discrimination, and our obligations under the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, which declared it the policy of the state to resolve all issues in the best interests of the child and to make her welfare the state's paramount concern. Now, although you may say that 64 states which had ratified the Convention on Reduction of Statelessness may not constitute the majority of states, or that 60 countries which have passed legislation embodying the presumption provided for there does not constitute the majority of states, please note that in Rason versus Tagites, the Convention on Enforced Disappearances was considered generally accepted principle of international law, even if it had been ratified only by 16 states, and therefore did not even enter into force. And I mentioned the Convention on the Recognition and Enforcement of Foreign Judgments, which were adopted only by members of the European Common Market. But our own Supreme Court said that that convention should be followed here because it's generally accepted principle of international law. I believe we should not look only at the number of states which follow a principle in a treaty to which the Philippines is not a party. We should look also whether or not the principles of this generally accepted principle of international law can be deduced from principles which we follow in our constitution, like the right to equality, the right against discrimination, the right of the child against statelessness. And I think so, if we follow all these requirements for adopting a principle as a generally accepted principle of international law, I think we can arrive at the conclusion that the presumption accorded to a foundling is generally accepted principle of international law.
What I'm referring to is that you are invoking a general principle that no one should be stateless. But as you know, under our constitution, there are different kinds of citizenship. We have natural-born citizen, we have naturalized citizen, we have citizen by special act of Congress. Is there anything in this general principle of international law that will do away with all of this classification under the constitution? You don't have to answer that so as not to prolong this. No, you specify in your memorandum, if by virtue of these general principles of international law, we can do away with the distinctions done under the constitution. Under the constitution, as you see, we require natural-born citizenship in certain positions. We do not require this in lower positions or in the exercise of professions. But when it comes to the position of members of Congress, the Vice President, and the President, we require natural-born citizenship. Now you have to convince us that the general principle of international law that you are referring to will do away with this classification that is provided for under the Constitution, such that any person should have a nationality, and it should have all the rights of citizenship under our Constitution. I don't like to argue with you about this, but you just explained that in your memorandum. Now let us accept, for the sake of argument, that the conventions that you are referring to apply are already applicable to the Philippines. Now I want you to show also whether there is compliance with the provisions of this international convention. I'll read to you Article 15 of the 1930 Hague Convention on certain questions relating to the conflict of nationality laws. Article 15 says, where the nationality of a state is not acquired automatically by reason of birth on its territory, a child born on the territory of that state of parents having no nationality or of unknown nationality may obtain the nationality of said state. Now it says may obtain. The law of that state shall determine the conditions governing the acquisition of its nationality in such cases. So the convention is not self-executing.
No, I disagree, Your Honor. It says it refers to the law of the state, which in our case can include the Philippine Constitution as interpreted by the framers of the Constitution and according to their intent. A foundling is already a citizen of the Philippines. We do not need legislation, Your Honor.
Say, what was simply mentioned in the deliberation is that under international law, foundling, the citizenship of a foundling is already covered.
Yes, Your
Honor.
So
now I am referring to you a provision of international law convention or an international convention saying how the nationality of a foundling can be conferred.
Yes,
and
by
it
law.
It is by virtue of a law to be passed by the state. So I want to ask you, under our law, are foundlings automatically considered natural-born citizens? Do we have a law like that?
Yes. Law includes the Constitution as interpreted according to the intent. Because the Constitution is part, is law,
not,
Your Honor.
Let's not argue anymore about, just include in your memorandum a specific provision saying that a foundling is automatically considered a natural-born citizen under our laws, whether
would,
it is the Constitution or not.
The Domestic Adoption Act.
Mention a specific provision. I'm not asking you. I don't like to argue with you. I just want you to point that out because we cannot deal with generalization. We need to be very specific. Now, in the 1961 Convention on the Reduction of Statelessness, it says, upon application being lodged with the appropriate authority by or on behalf of the person concerned in the manner prescribed by the national law, the state shall grant the nationality to a person born in its territory who would otherwise be stateless. So again, it refers to an application in the manner prescribed by national law. Then there is another provision in this 1961 convention. It says, the contracting state may also provide for the grant of its nationality by operation of law. So there must be a law at such age and subject to such conditions as may be prescribed by national law. So you tell us what law, what Philippine law grant natural-born citizenship to a foundling and under what conditions. So you're invoking international law, so you have to show that there is compliance with all of these provisions of international law insofar as a foundling is concerned. And you should be specific, not to deal with generalities. Now let's go to the finding of the Bureau of Immigration, or the order of the Bureau of Immigration granting the petition of the senator and her children to reacquire Filipino citizenship. It says here, a careful review of the documents submitted to support the instant petition indicate that the petitioner was a former citizen of the Republic of the Philippines, having been born to Filipino citizen, and from there it was presumed that she is a natural-born citizen of the Philippines. What was submitted by the petitioner to the Bureau of Immigration that made the Bureau of Immigration render this finding that she was born to Filipino parents? It was not based on the fact that she was a foundling or an adopted child. It says here there was evidence presented that she was born to Filipino parents. That was the basis of the Bureau of Immigration order. So you give us the basis of the Bureau of Immigration in making this finding that she was born to Filipino parents.
Your Honor, according to the rules, that finding could be made on the basis of an old Filipino passport, which was submitted. From the fact that a passport was issued to her, the BI properly presumed that she was a Filipino Filipino.
There was no presumption. It says she was born to. It was a fact, a finding of fact. She was born to a Filipino parent. And the presumption only was about her being a natural-born citizen based on the fact that she was born to Filipino parents. So there was no presumption about the fact of being born to Filipino parents.
Your Honor, the rules...
It was a fact.
The rules of the BI established a presumption that a former Filipino citizen who presents an old Philippine passport is presumed to be natural born. That is in the rules. So even those rules should be accorded the presumption of regularity. Now, I think there is a mention here that in the petition for approval of the application, there was a mention there of who the parents are. And petitioner wrote the name of her adoptive parents. But the mere fact that she was adopted also already reinforces the presumption entertained by the BI that she was a Filipino. Because how could she be adopted if she were not a Filipino?
Let's put it this way. What I'm trying to drive at is that the order of the BI granting the petition was based on its finding of fact that she was born to Filipino parents. And from there, there was an assumption or presumption that she is a natural-born Filipino. So there is no presumption as to the fact of her parentage. The BI relied on the truthfulness of the allegation of the petitioner that she was born to Filipino parents. That was the basis of the order.
No, Your
it
Honor.
It is not based on the presumption that she was a foundling or an adopted child.
It was based on the presumption because according to the rules of the BI, it is sufficient. I'm sorry, Your Honor.
Let's not put words into this order. The order is plain and simple. The language is clear. There is no presumption as to her parentage. The BI made a finding, a categorical finding, that she was born to Filipino parents. And that was the basis of the BI in saying that she is presumed natural born.
It was a finding based on a presumption that is provided for in the rules.
So I just want you to.
Yes, Your Honor.
My purpose in asking this question is to ask you, what document did she submit to the Bureau of Immigration that made the immigration believe that she was born to Filipino parents?
Philippine passport, old Philippine passport.
Just the Philippine passport.
And the application, the petition itself, Your Honor.
But as a matter of fact, she was not born to Filipino parents.
That was a presumption which could be made rules of the BI.
The fact is, and it is not disputed even here, that she was a foundling and that she was adopted.
Yeah, even if she were adopted, that only reinforces the presumption that she was a Filipino and a natural-born Filipino because how could she be otherwise? Okay. She was a newborn infant. She could not have been naturalized.
I just want to bring out the
yes, Your Honor.
Plainly written here in the order that it was her representation that she was born to Filipino parents. And that
yes,
was the basis for the presumption that she is a natural born Filipino. That's now I just one more item. I'm looking at the document that she submitted concerning her departure and arrival to the Philippines. So up to up to November 2007, her status based on this Bureau of Immigration document is that she came here under BB. That is what is indicated here, BB. I take it means Balikbayan. Balikbayan, this is BB.
Yes, I believe so, Your Honor. The question is, did she come as a Balikbayan?
Up to that time, up to May 2008, up to November 2007, her status was BB. And she was using her American passport. Now, after that, she still used her American passport up to, based on this document, up to November 2009. And from May 2008 to November 2009, what was indicated as her status was RC. What does that mean? Returning citizen? What does RC mean? What does RC mean?
What is that?
RC?
RC, I believe, means recognition.
Certificate.
Certificate. Recognition.
What is it? What is it?
That's the 9225 certification that she had reacquired Philippine citizenship.
RC, that's RC? Is it returning citizen? Is that not? What is it?
Resident, it means, Your Honor, I'm sorry, it means resident citizen.
Okay, so
that's
a resident citizen.
Yes, Your
so,
Honor.
So that was only from May 8, 2008. Up to November 15, 2009. That's still RC. That's when RC. Her status was indicated as RC, and up to that period, she was still using her American passport. Okay, that's all. I just want to clarify what BB and what RC means.
Yes, we will address that in our...
And the passport that she was using up to November 2009 was her American passport, 01703-7793.
Yes.
Okay, that's all.
Justice Del Castillo.
Just three short questions, Counsel.
Yes, Your Honor.
Earlier you mentioned something about recantation of renunciation of American citizenship. And that would not have taken place had the petitioner used her U.S. passport after renouncing her American citizenship in October of 2010. But she said that she did not. What would be the effect of the recantation of renunciation of her American citizenship? What would have been the effect?
Had she used her U.S. passport
after
October 20, 2010,
yes.
Then under the ruling in Makiling, I believe, that would recant her renunciation of the U.S. citizenship.
Yes, that's right. What would happen if her renunciation of American citizenship would have been recanted? What would happen then?
Then she would remain a dual citizen. She would become a dual citizen. It will not affect her reacquisition of Philippine citizenship. But then it will only recant her renunciation of U.S. citizenship. I think she would revert to be a dual citizen.
Is that the effect?
I believe so.
You mean the acquisition of dual citizenship will be automatic upon the recantation of the affidavit of renunciation? Immediately, she becomes a dual citizenship again and therefore disqualified from running for public office?
It might depend on U.S. law also, because U.S. law might consider her not to be a U.S. citizen anymore, in which case she would only be a Philippine citizen because her use of the Philippine passport will not affect her reacquisition of Philippine citizenship.
Don't you think that she would be disqualified from running for public office because she has failed to comply with the twin requirements of
yes.
RA 9225?
Yes,
and not because she automatically become an American citizen.
As a dual citizen, she would be disqualified
yes.
to run for public office.
These days, we also often hear, let the people exercise their sovereign right to elect their leaders. Let their voices be heard, Vox Populi, Vox Dei. But isn't the Constitution also the voice of the people? After all, it was that document will not be the Constitution if it was not ratified by majority of the people in the referendum.
That's true, but the same Constitution in certain instances allow, if not require, the people to decide certain issues. For example, in case of doubt with regard to the qualifications of a citizenship, according to the Supreme Court, it is best for the people to decide first that issue, and then the Supreme Court can step in should that candidate win and be proclaimed.
And the 15 of us unelected members of the court here, we cannot also shirk from our solemn obligation to interpret the Constitution as has been, I mean, you know, ours is a tripartite form of government, and you know that is our solemn obligation as well.
Yes, but I think it's the duty of the Supreme Court here is not being questioned. It's just what is the right timing? Does the Constitution first require that the people should decide it, and then when the president is elected and proclaimed, then then should the Supreme Court step in and decide as the sole judge of qualifications of the president?
Thank you, counsel.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Justice Perez.
Just a basic issue, Mr. Counsel. What really is the purpose of these proceedings? Is the purpose to determine whether or not the petitioner is indeed qualified, or to put it more specifically, whether or not the petitioner is indeed natural born, or that she has the required 10-year residency prior to the election? Or are these two issues merely on the table only for the purpose of determining whether or not there was false material representation in the certificate of candidacy that the petitioner filed?
The issue before this honorable court is whether or not there was grave abuse of discretion on the part of the COMELEC. If I may use as a guide the Supreme Court decision in Texon, the Supreme Court there said, while the totality of the evidence is not conclusive that Fernando Po was a natural-born citizen, at the very least, it preponderates in favor of Fernando Po enough for us to conclude that there was no deliberate material misrepresentation on his part when he represented to be a natural-born Filipino. So the issue also before this court is not whether or not the candidate is disqualified, but whether or not, in light of the positions that may be taken with respect to the issue of qualification, there was good faith on the part of the candidate. But having said that, the issue of material misrepresentation may restrict the power of the COMELEC, but it may not necessarily restrict the discretion of the Supreme Court, because the Supreme Court will have to define the perimeter of its own discretion. And there are jurisprudence to the effect, when all the facts are before the court, when all the issues have been exhaustively discussed, nothing prevents the court from addressing the issues and the merits.
Okay. Let us move forward. The Supreme Court finally decides that the petitioner does not have the residency requirement, is not a natural born citizen. Does that mean that she materially, that she made false representation on a material fact?
No, Your Honor. If the finding is that she is not a natural born Filipino, she does not meet the residence requirement, the Supreme Court can still make a finding that, considering that this is a difficult issue, that both sides can, in good faith, assume certain positions without necessarily indulging in deceit, then it does not follow that the candidate necessarily is guilty of...
And there can be no final decision regarding the qualification of the petitioner.
Your Honor, this simply means that if this court, honorable court, finds that there was no material misrepresentation on the part of the petitioner, then she should be allowed, her COC should be restored. She should be allowed to run, and if she wins, then the issues can be revived before the Supreme Court.
Let's go back. When you say it is a false material representation, against what is that measured? Is the representation measured? Is that against the truth or against established fact? Because how can you say there is material representation without comparing or without looking at that material representation vis-a-vis
a standard,
which is established fact, or something which is undebatable or beyond debate?
In the extreme case that the issues of law and fact are clear-cut, then it can be said that petitioner should have known or ought to have known, according to the COMELEC, that is already basis for saying there was deceit on her part. But I feel that this honorable court should not only look at what the issue of law or fact is, it should also look at the intent of the petitioner, given
I'm willing to go back to the more basic issue. At this point, is there already established fact or an undeniable fact, undebatable fact, against which the representation of the petitioner in her certificate of candidacy can be measured to make the conclusion that such representation is false?
There is none. On the contrary, we have the SET decision. Can we say that the SET should have known or ought to have known, and therefore when it issued its decision, it was not acting in good faith? Absolutely not. We have to defer also to the good faith and the regularity of the SET decision. And based on the SET decision, petitioner could not have been in bad faith when she said she was a natural born Filipino.
So you're saying, of course, that since the COMELEC went on to decide against the petitioner in spite of the absence of established fact against which the representation should be measured or can be measured, then the COMELEC acted without jurisdiction.
Yes, I agree. A grave abuse of discretion amounting to lack of jurisdiction.
I ask that question also for the respondents to tackle when their turn comes up.
Justice Velasco.
Counsel, good afternoon. Will you tell me if there's a case already decided by this court on the issue of the nationality of a foundling?
there is a old case, the spouses Ellis versus government versus Republic. It involved adoption. The adoption was being petitioned for by foreigners. Under these facts of the case, the supposed adoptee was left in a hospital by an identified mother. Therefore, her citizenship could not be determined. Supreme Court said, we have to dismiss the petition for adoption because the petitioners are foreigners, and therefore the court cannot have jurisdiction over the adoption, although it has jurisdiction over the child. The court there just assumed that a foundling was a Filipino, and therefore the Philippine court has jurisdiction over her rest or her status. As you know, when it comes to civil or status of an individual, the jurisdiction of the court will depend on the nationality of the adoptee or the child.
Okay, but that factual milieu does not apply to the case at bar, right?
It does apply because petitioner was issued a founding certificate. Her decree of adoption, in fact, acknowledges that she is a foundling. In fact, it refers to her as a foundling twice in that brief decree of adoption.
The reason why I'm saying it's not applicable is because the issue right now is whether a foundling has the status of a natural born citizen. And that issue was not squarely ruled upon by the court in that case you cited. Is that correct?
Yes, not squarely, but that conclusion can be reached. The court could not have, I agree, it's an interpretation which can be made on the basis of that decision.
Okay. In your presentation in the last hearing, you made mention of an acquisition of domicile through an incremental process. Did you say that?
Yes, Your Honor.
And what do you mean by that?
Well, it means that relocation or reestablishment of residence need not be accomplished in a single act. It can be accomplished in a series of incremental acts, so long as an intent to remain underlies the incremental process. The candidate can be considered to have reestablished her residence at the start of that process. That was mentioned in the case of Mitra versus Comelec.
Mitra versus Comelec. Do you remember the facts of the case? Can you briefly tell us how we ruled in that case?
I believe in that case, Mitra was a three-termer member of Congress three times, and he was residing in Puerto Princesa. Puerto Princesa was declared a highly urbanized city, and therefore it was removed from the jurisdiction of the district where Mitra used to be a congressman. So Mitra wanted to run as governor. So he had to re-establish his residence outside of the city, and he chose the municipality of Aborlan. Now he established himself in this mezzanine floor of a farm and feed mill. This feed mill occupied rented land. And he acquired property but was never able to buy property, never able to build his house there. The court said that although his residence was on rented land, still that can be considered as a residence for purposes of election, and considering the process of his relocation, the entire process should be considered as an incremental process. And this is hand in hand with the principle that the totality of evidence should be considered. Court should not look at each piece of evidence in isolation.
That residence in the feed mill, do you remember the amenities of that particular room? Do you remember if that was fit for a congressman who intended to run for the position of governor? Do you remember the condition of the alleged residence of Mitra in that feed mill?
Oh yes.
Is that habitable, or are you comfortable in that?
There was the claim there of the other party that the mezzanine floor, that small room, was not fit for a former congressman, that it could not have been his residence. And the court said we should not rely on subjective standards to determine residence, because there are objective standards, and the objective standard would require only whether or not he had actually resided there and he had intended to stay there.
Does it have a comfort room and a shower facilities?
I wouldn't know, but probably, well, the court, I think, look at the totality of the evidence.
Mm-hmm. I remember that case because I dissented to the majority ruling there. But Mitra there acquired a piece of land sometime in June of 2009, and the elections were held on May 10, 2010. And at the time of the elections, the house was not yet completed. And you subscribe to the ruling of the court there that through an incremental process, one can acquire a domicile?
I believe, Your Honor, that in most cases, relocation is a difficult process, so it can take time and several steps. But if you look at the process itself in totality, then residents can be considered to be reestablished in that situation.
What are the elements of acquiring domicile?
Physical presence, intent to stay, so that there may be temporary instances when the candidate in question may leave that place, but if there's always an intent to return, then domicile is established. If it's a change of domicile, then there's a third requirement. There must be no intent to return to the old domicile.
And based on the evidence adduced by your client, you feel that all the elements were met?
I believe so, Your Honor. If you apply strictly the requirements under election law, without looking at the label of the visa, the name of the government permit which allowed her here. But if you look only at the standards of physical presence, intent to stay, intent not to return to the U.S., she established her citizenship, her residence in the Philippines.
Is it your position that the petitioner here was able to acquire her domicile in the Philippines through the incremental process as initiated in the Mitra case?
Yes, Your Honor. Because when she came back with her kids, they had no property or place to stay. She had to stay with her mother. A few months after, they were able to buy a condominium unit where they eventually stayed. At that time, their house in the U.S. had not yet been sold. Their assets there had not yet been sold. Then, over a period of time, their assets were shipped here through several containers. Their house was eventually sold. Immediately thereafter, her husband resigned from his job and returned here. So it's a process which started in 2005, but went on even during 2006 in an incremental way.
Okay. And you made mention of Sobile. That was another case where I dissented to the majority ruling. So can you explain that in your memo? Because position there is that is really contrary to the majority ruling. Thank you, counsel.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Now I get my chance, finally.
Yes, Your Honor.
Counsel, I'm very interested in one aspect of your petition. that you started but you did not fully elaborate on. And this is the case of this is the case of Ching Leng versus Galang. You remember that case, counsel?
I'm sorry, Your Honor. I cannot remember it right now.
You mentioned that in your petition. That's why I went through that.
I'll just...
Okay. This is what I will just very briefly allow me to summarize. Ching Leng used to be a Chinese citizen, but he eventually became a naturalized Filipino under the Naturalization Act. Now, he ultimately adopted his five illegitimate children, and he immediately thought that it would be an administrative matter, of course, for the Commissioner of Immigration to cancel their alien certificates of registration and issue whatever kind of certificate evidences the fact that they are now automatically Filipino citizens. All right. The court denied because it said that this is not a proper petition for mandamus. So on procedural grounds, he denied the petition. And then it included a statement that the adoption does not include the acquisition of the nationality of the adopter. In other words, with respect to the alien children of a Filipino who became Filipino through naturalization, the citizenship is not immediately transmitted to the children. Okay, you remember that now?
Yes.
Because you were the one who raised that in your petition. Now, I don't know, I have to be corrected on this if I am wrong, but there were two decisions that mentioned the Ching Leng case. And this is Tan Hoi, and in the matter of the petition of the minor Charles Joseph Weeks. Okay. In both decisions where the court adverted to the Ching Leng decision, both of the facts involved the request for the automatic transmittal of the citizenship of the one person who has already been naturalized to the child to be adopted. Now, I thought that perhaps the case of your client might actually be different.
Yes, Your Honor.
Because in those three cases, we have a situation where the nationalities of adopter and adoptee are different. Yeah. And the construction by the court is that there is no automatic transmission of rights or transmission of nationality immediately. Is that correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. Are those cases different from your case?
I think in those cases, the question merely is that we have the facts, if I may summarize them, we have a foreigner who is naturalized, who becomes a naturalized Filipino. But this naturalized Filipino had illegitimate children. The question is, would the naturalization of the foreigner benefit the illegitimate children? Situation is different in the sense that petitioner is a foundling. She underwent adoption process on the basis of a foundling certificate, and the decree of adoption expressly acknowledged that she was a foundling.
Okay. Now, so the blank here that we need to supply is what is her citizenship as a foundling before she was adopted.
Yes, Your Honor.
Now, you made a case and you started planting the seed of an idea with respect to how you construe Article 15 of the Civil Code. And what does Article 15 say?
I believe it says that the rights relating to status of an individual will depend on the law, the law of the nationality of the individual.
It says laws relating to family rights, duties, status, condition, legal capacity of persons are binding on citizens of the Philippines even though living abroad.
Yes.
And then we have a reverse restatement or a negative restatement of that. If this is a positive statement on the fact that nationality laws attach rights, duties, status, condition, legal capacity attached to the nationality, the reverse is true. And if you can state the reverse rule, what is the reverse rule?
That the court can exercise jurisdiction over the status, the jurisdiction of the court over the status of an individual is determined by the nationality of that individual.
That's the positive statement. And the negative, therefore, is what?
If the individual does not have the nationality of the state where the court sits, the court has no jurisdiction to determine the status of that individual.
What is the doctrine of contemporaneous construction as well as the doctrine of administrative interpretation or construction?
The court should construe a law in conjunction with other laws covering the same subject matter or covering the same area. To the best of my ability, that's how I recollect the principle, Your Honor.
I fully understand because it's already past five. So, would you know the particular section of the Domestic Adoption Act regarding children of unknown parents, specifically Section 5? As well as I'll already guide you so that we can move along and hopefully terminate the proceedings. Section 8, paragraph B. Can you read section 5 for us, please?
Can I have a few moments, Your Honor?
Okay, I will read it so that we don't waste time looking for it's all right. I understand it's very late. Section 5 states, location, the title, an act establishing this is RA 8552, an act establishing the rules and policies on the domestic adoption of Filipino children.
Yes.
And for other purposes. All right, it says, Section 5, location of unknown parents. It shall be the duty of the department or the child placing or child caring agency, which has custody of the child, to exert all efforts to locate his or her unknown biological parents. If such efforts fail, the child shall be registered as a foundling and subsequently be the subject of legal proceedings where he or she shall be declared abandoned. Meaning foundlings are covered by the rules on the adoption of Filipino children. What do you see from that?
That can only mean, Your Honor, that under this law, a foundling is considered a Filipino. Otherwise, the court cannot decree their adoption.
May the legislature contemporaneously interpret the Constitution or even subsequently interpret a constitutional provision that had been put there in 35 or in 87?
Yes, I believe the legislature can interpret the Constitution, but their interpretation is consistent with the rule on adoption promulgated by the Supreme Court, Your Honor.
Yes, in Inter-Country Adoption Act, which is again a Republic Act 8043. Would you know this time the title of this? It has it been handed to you already? Would you have RA 8043 this time? So I'm talking already of one law, RA 8552, which talks about domestic adoption with a very clear title. Now we go to RA 8043. Okay, I will just read for you the title. It says, an act establishing the rules to govern inter-country adoption of Filipino children and for other purposes. Okay? Can you now go to Section 8, please, specifically Paragraph B?
Who may be adopted? Section 8, who may be adopted? Only a legally free child may be the subject of inter-country adoption. In order that such child may be considered for placement, the following documents must be submitted to the board. B, birth certificate / foundling certificate.
So it means that foundlings fall under the coverage of the Inter-Country Adoption Act of Filipino children.
Yes, Your Honor.
Is there something that we can conclude by way of legislative interpretation of the Constitution of this,
yes,
of this title and the aforesaid provision?
This is the same conclusion, Your Honor. The legislature itself accords foundlings the presumption of citizenship.
Now we go to Supreme Court Rules on Adoption, AM number 02-6-02-SC-2002. And we go to Section 9. Do you have Section 9?
We will get it, Your Honor. Section 9. Adoption of a foundling, an abandoned, dependent, or neglected child. In case the adoptee is a foundling, an abandoned, dependent, or neglected child, the petition shall allege A, the facts showing that the child is a foundling, abandoned, dependent, or neglected, the names of the parents if known, and their residence. If the child has no known or living parents, then the name and residence of the guardian, if any.
No, and it's all right. All right. Now, can you relate this to Article 15,
same,
which the Supreme Court is very cognizant of? Do we have the jurisdiction to make the rules on the adoption of foundlings if we completely disregard the implications of Article 15?
No, Your Honor. No court can acquire jurisdiction over a foundling if the foundling is not presumed Filipino. That would violate Article 15 of the Civil Code.
Can you describe to us the situation if the court will say that the statement found in Glenching was not just limited to the situation of an alien wanting the automatic transmission of his new naturalized status to his illegitimate children? Can you tell us what the implication is for the entire country?
Well,
if we were to extend it to say that Glenching is a hard and fast rule, and that the statement there is not limited to that situation, but it refers to all adoption situations, what is the going to be the effect on all children, especially foundlings?
Well, then, in that situation, courts will in fact decree the adoption of the children of a naturalized individual without regard to their true nationality, which would determine the jurisdiction of the court. And
It will basically have the following effects. First, it will be contrary to Article 15. Then, do you know Article 6 of the Civil Code? I think it's Article 6 or Article 8. In the face of the silence, obscurity, or ambiguity of the law, the court is still required to render a decision. Because the presumption is that laws, including the Constitution, can be silent, obscure, or ambiguous, correct?
Yes, Your Honor.
So that that is the time you come to an interpretation.
Yes, Your Honor.
And then another provision there, when, and that is the presumption again, I just don't have this, that the law intends justice,
yes,
and
right to prevail.
And right to prevail.
Yes, Your Honor.
So the point of us making sure that justice prevails is not a vox populi requirement. I disagree with that. It is a duty which justices are required to observe, because it is even statutorily required of us in keeping with our mandate under the civil code, and it is required by the inherent functions that we are exercising as a court. So you understand that?
Yes, Your Honor.
Oh, so can you try to find out, in fact, if the court makes a conclusion against foundlings who are being adopted, what do you think will be the possible policy implications that will result in the desirability of adopting foundlings vis-a-vis those with known biological parents?
No one will adopt foundlings because of the possibility that the decree of adoption can be challenged on the ground of lack of jurisdiction on the part of the court.
There will be a legal problem because of the application of Article 15.
Yes, Your Honor.
Where there is no jurisdiction over the subject of the adoption.
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. Another, if you are going to have to go through the challenge, if you are one looking to adopt a child between one with a known biological parent and a foundling, who will you prefer to adopt?
Child of known parents, Your Honor.
And because of that, what will happen to foundlings who are found in the Philippines? Of course, foundlings in the Philippines.
They will remain in orphanages, Your Honor, and public institutions.
So does the Constitution envision a situation where foundlings, there will be a discouragement to the adoption of foundlings?
No, on the contrary, the policy is to resolve all doubts in the best interests of children, including foundlings, Your Honor, because their concern is paramount to the state.
In fact, if we rule completely against foundling rights, will there be a disincentive with respect to parents or persons who found foundlings to still register them as foundlings?
Births will be simulated, Your Honor. So there will be falsification in the reporting of births.
So there will be an increase in the simulation of births.
Yes,
in other words, we will increase the possibility of affidavits that will falsely say that one is a child of X, Y, or Z,
yes,
simply because the registration of a foundling immediately works a disadvantage to the foundling.
Yes, Your Honor.
The foundling will be discriminated against from the time that the foundling is found, because the registration papers will be, the disincentive to regularize these papers will be there.
Yes.
The adoption also, will there be a disincentive to the adoption of foundlings?
Yes, Your Honor.
Will there be now a question always as to the status of these children?
Yes, Your Honor.
And is that a situation that the Constitution envisions that should result from our decision?
I don't think so, Your Honor.
Okay, can you elaborate on that? Because I'm very interested, because there are more and more parents right now who want to adopt. And many times, they don't understand the kind of legal problems that they are going to encounter. What this court is going to say will speak to them. They will make the decision matrix depending on how we view our constitutional duty to be. Whether we find it strictly by saying that the language is silent, so the rights of foundlings are completely silent, or it will go through a situation where it will resort to interpretation in accordance with not only statutory construction, but also judicial interpretation and also administrative practices in order that a just and right ruling will result. We want to be elaborated on that because the implication of this case is very profound, not only for your client, actually we can put a blinder on who your client is and just focus on the implication on foundling rights who are being required by the position of petitioners to prove an impossible condition.
Yes.
And under the basic doctrines of law, how do we treat an impossible condition?
It is precisely in this situation where presumptions of law should apply.
Because when it comes to obligations, they are considered as not imposed. Impossible conditions are construed as not imposed.
Yes, Your Honor.
So assuming that there is a burden to prove qualification and the burden equates to who your parents are, if the candidate herself does not even know who her parents are or cannot prove it, what is the implication of the rule on impossible conditions?
Either the burden is reversed or the burden is deemed discharged and the burden should now shift to the other, to the petitioner, as it should.
Okay, so I want you to look at how the courts use those statements in Glenching and to find some limitations, because we have to be careful that we are not, by a rigid reading of what we consider as failure to enumerate foundlings, we are going to create a unintended consequences, the difficulties of which are not, perhaps not even going to just be visited on your client, but on so many foundlings in this country.
Yes,
can you elaborate on that?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. Now, when you were talking about admissions against interest, what is the rule on admissions against interest? Can you read it for us again, please?
It says an admission against interest may be admissible.
But may be given in evidence against him.
Yes, Your Honor.
In other words, it is just a rule of
admissibility.
It is just a threshold. There is still something that must be done by a judge who admits that evidence.
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay. Now, you're talking about the COMELEC ruling having been summary. In other words, they immediately allow all kinds of evidence to come in and they come up with their decision. Are you saying that when the COC was sought to be introduced against you as evidence, you did not have the occasion to object to their admissibility?
We did object to the admissibility. No, what is said, Your Honor, is that although admissible, they have no weight at all because...
That's actually my question. So, admissibility, you would not have contested at all.
Yes.
Whether it was in a full-blown proceedings where you were asked in the offer of evidence or when the testimony or the document was being sought to be introduced against you, you did not have the chance to object. And even if you had the chance, you would not have objected.
Yes, but effectively we objected because
yes,
we said...
You would not have objected because it's admissible.
Yes,
you are saying that?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, but what is the conclusiveness? In other words, what does a good judge have to still do with respect to an admissible piece of evidence?
Not only is it not conclusive, it should be disregarded according to the cases of Romualdez Marcos and Perez versus COMELEC, Your Honor. It is the fact of residence which should be determinative or which should be decisive.
All right, so you actually can say that though admissible, under a previous ruling by this court, that is not conclusive.
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, assume for the purposes of just this particular questioning that Romualdez Marcos case does not exist. What was the duty of a good judge in that case?
it should have considered other evidence which would show whether or not residence was actually
established. In other words, the COC of 2012 against all the other evidence.
Yes,
lined up one by one with a discussion.
Yes, Your Honor.
Now, if there is just a conclusion, we have considered all the evidence, will that be sufficient?
It will be grave abuse of discretion. I think it's exactly in the same situation as, I believe, Sabili, where the court examine each evidence,
yes,
one by one, and weighed them in totality.
Yes,
that should have been the procedure which was.
Yeah, I wrote Sabili.
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay, so I went through a very tedious examination of all the records, and how did I finally suggest to my colleagues? But of course, it is a collegial decision. How do we look at the evidence portion of the decision?
Look at them in totality, Your Honor.
Did we weigh one piece of evidence against another?
I believe so. They were actually matched against each other, Your Honor. Evidence for an evidence against.
And do you think that this is a good standard that has been set by the court?
Yes, Your Honor. That should have been followed also.
Well, I want to find out, and in fact, I'm going to be very interested because of I want to find out what the COMELEC has to say about Sabili.
Yes, Your Honor.
Which Justice Velasco already said he dissents from. So, with that, I find actually that when you were discussing international law, you may have failed to miss the richness of domestic law itself.
Yes.
That the constitutional history is a very rich mine for us to propound from. That we actually needed to deepen our understanding of ourselves as a people. And from there, you know, these very good provisions or doctrines that have been laid down by the Supreme Court for decades about construing and interpreting the life of the Constitution, that actually has a rich, rich repository of ideas from which to draw your insights from. So actually, it is possible that you may have limited your view in that you did not see that we have so many lofty doctrines, decisions, and thinking that are already here in domestic law.
That may be true, Your Honor, but I did say that in Rason versus Tagites and Mijares versus Granada, the court, after serving the regional practice, they went back to basic principles of law in the Philippines. Principles under our constitution, principles under Rule 39 of the Rules of Court.
Actually, some of the justices here were already hinting about that.
Yes.
The totality of the constitution construed. So, in any case, it is already 5:30. If my colleagues do not have any further question, we may actually call it a day. Unless my colleagues want to hear the opening statement, is there any of the COMELEC, we can actually call it a day. There being no request from any of our colleagues to immediately proceed to the portion where the COMELEC will bring forth its interpellation, the session is hereby adjourned to resume next Tuesday, same time, same venue.